Donald Trump said yesterday that the only way to stop corporations from hiding money overseas is by lowering taxes. Right. And the way to end murder is by legalizing it. It's 3 a.m. Tuesday, May 2nd, 2017. I'm David Feldman. We have a lot of show, so let's get right to it.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, DavidFeldmanShow.com. On today's program, Eddie Pepitone, the Bitter Buddha, joins us. Colleen Werthmann from The Nightly Show and Throwing Shade. She's back in the building. Colleen Werthmann is home from Los Angeles. You know who else is home from Los Angeles? Liam McEneaney. He's back. He's in the building. Liam and Colleen hijacked the show for me. Also, Professor Corey Brettschneider is back for our free course in constitutional law. Stay with me.
Yes! Howdy, partner.
What's up, basement masturbators? I'm Colleen Werthmann. You're listening to the David Feldman Show.
Yo, yo, yo. You're listening to the hottest show on podcast. I'm Liam McEneaney. It's David Feldman Show right now. Ah.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Listeners to this show will be sad for me to tell you that we lost a friend. Gary Shapiro was buried yesterday. Gary was no stranger to this program. He hosted it. He would do song parodies. He was a constant companion to me and people like Paul Prevenza. You might have remembered him from The Green Room. Gary was a comedian, a comedy writer, a musician, a cantor, and a rabbi who never had a bad word to say about anybody. He probably was the most loved person in our community, on this show and in Los Angeles, and we lost him last week. I don't know what happened. He was about my age, and if you want to familiarize yourself with Gary Shapiro, Google him or look for his song parodies on YouTube or go to my website and type in Gary Shapiro, and you can hear some of the episodes with Gary Shapiro. The story I always tell about Gary Shapiro, when we were doing Green Room for Showtime, Gary was working on it, and he attended the after party. One of my sons was being bar mitzvahed at the time. He was studying the Torah, and we looked over at the party, and Gary Shapiro, in his left hand, had a corned beef sandwich. In his right hand, he had a glass of scotch, and somebody was putting a hash pipe into his mouth. And I pointed to Gary and said to my son, "Now that's a rabbi." Gary was a cantor, a rabbi, and just, we all loved him. It was the easiest thing to do in the world was to love Gary Shapiro. And I'll play some of his song parodies next week. Yeah, Gary Shapiro was and is a miracle. A miracle. Welcome back. We did a live show at QED last Saturday night. You're going to hear it Friday morning at 3 a.m. And I want to thank everybody for showing up. It was great. It's great to meet the listeners. A lot of you drove in as far away as from Long Island and And we're going to be doing a lot more of these live shows. Again, this Friday at 3 a.m., you'll hear the live show that we taped at QED in Astoria. It features Sean Donnelly from Conan and Letterman, Angela Cobb. She's an hysterical young comic. And you know him, you hate him, the undefeated roast battle champion of New York City, Pat Dixon, from the New York City Crime Report, joined us live on stage. Many of my listeners complain about Pat's politics. I agree. Detestable. He's reprehensible politically, but I like the guy. And as long as we don't discuss politics, he's funny and interesting. Which begs the question, can you like somebody if they like Trump? And the answer is no, you cannot. One of my sons has a godfather who voted for George W. Bush in 2004, and I stopped speaking to this guy because it's unforgivable. People say to me, you know, politics isn't that important. You shouldn't let politics get in the way of friendships. And I say, politics is everything. It's everything now. Right now it is. In 2004 it was, when we were fighting an illegal war in Iraq. And politics is everything right now, because it reveals so much of who you are. Normally, it doesn't. But there are times in history when your politics determine whether or not you're going to be my friend. It's crunch time right now. It's cards on the table. If you're behind this administration, if you defend the terror of undocumented Americans. I was on the subway in New York today, and the state of New York is running an advertisement for undocumented immigrants. And it says, if any of your loved ones are missing, call this number. Do you know what that means? That means that undocumented workers are being rounded up by ICE, being separated from their children, their wives and their husbands, their grandchildren and their grandparents, and they've gone missing because Donald Trump has this deportation force called ICE that is rounding up innocent people and removing them from our country. And there are now signs in the New York subway with pictures of frightened children saying, if one of your loved ones is missing, contact this number. The state of New York is helping undocumented immigrants find their loved ones because they've been rounded up by ICE. This is what the country has become. This is where we're at. If you're miserable, that means you've got your finger on the pulse. If you're miserable right now and unhappy, you should be. This is absolutely horrible. I cannot be friends with anybody who condones Trump. Sure, when things are going well, it doesn't matter what your politics are. This is getting worse and worse. Trump fatigue, for me, is gone. My juices are flowing again. My blood is boiling. And I am utterly convinced that if you're a Trump supporter, you're just like a child molester. Because just like a child molester, you cannot be cured. Nothing you can tell a Trump supporter will change them, just like a child molester. You need to identify the Trump supporters. They need to wear ankle bracelets at all times because there is no treatment for a Trump supporter. Just like a child molester, you cannot tell them anything. You cannot cure a Trump supporter. All that being said, I like Pat Dixon. I don't think I could be friends with him. I don't think he'd ever be the godfather to my children. But, you know, I like Pat Dixon. He's a funny guy. Yes, he's ignorant, absolutely, but that's what makes him funny. And as long as you don't take him seriously or elect him president, and on election day keep him tied up in your basement so he can't cast a ballot, he's perfectly harmless. I don't know. I like Pat Dixon the same way I liked Rickles, even though I didn't approve of what Rickles said about women, gays, blacks, Jews, and Mexicans. I like Don Rickles. You know, Rickles played for Reagan's second inaugural. Reagan ruined this country, but we still like Rickles. It's tough. It's unforgivable, Pat Dixon, that you're voting and supporting Trump. There's something seriously wrong with you, but because you're funny, you're welcome on this show. Anyway, it's a great live show. It drops this Friday at 3 a.m. Yes, I'm back. I've been away. I just haven't been paying attention to the news. I have been paying attention to the news. I just don't want to talk about it because it kind of felt like a bad relationship, Trump and the Republicans, a guy who just keeps punching you and you keep asking why he's punching you or talking about each punch as though they're different. These are just murderous, violent people. But now I want to punch back. Trump's chief of staff, Rince Priebus, who, as we all know, killed 14 male prostitutes in April, said yesterday that he's looking into changing libel laws for press outlets. Chief of Staff Rince Priebus, the murderer of 14 male prostitutes in April, is looking into ways the Trump administration can change libel laws and prosecute members of the media. Meanwhile, Donald Trump gave an interview where he said, "Hey, what's the deal with the Civil War? And why did we have to fight it? Why couldn't we have worked it out? You know, a deal. Why couldn't somebody like Andrew Jackson have made a deal? You know, it's too bad Trump wasn't around to work out a deal back during the Civil War, like letting the South secede. On one hand, there'd be no South, but on the other hand, Hillary would be president." Trump actually asked yesterday why America had a Civil War. And, you know, all he has to do is stay in office for a few more months, and he'll find out why America had a Civil War. Trust me. People are pissed off. Yesterday was May Day. Look at the streets. People were pissed off, and they still are. More bad news for Fox News. Bill Shine was fired. Shine was right underneath Roger Ailes because he was the only one over at Fox News willing to fillet Roger Ailes. Shine is gone. Sean Hannity has been tweeting in the lead up to Shine's firing that if Shine is fired, Hannity will leave Fox News, thereby marking the first time in history Hannity has ever said anything that I actually hoped was true. Meanwhile, Trump and the Republicans averted a government shutdown by shutting down everything Donald Trump stands for. There is no funding for Trump's border wall, no provision to defund Planned Parenthood. 99% of the funding for the EPA will stay intact. There is no deportation force. We still have ICE, but Trump had promised to create a deportation force to assist ICE in separating undocumented workers from their children. Medicaid subsidies for Obamacare are staying put. Trump had threatened to cut funding for the National Institutes of Health because why do we need the National Institutes of Health? Well, to keep the government open, they agreed to a $2 billion increase for the National Institutes of Health. The new continuing resolution to keep the government open has no provision in it to defund sanctuary cities or sanctuary states like New York, which now has signs on the subway telling undocumented workers, call this number if one of your loved ones has been snatched by Donald Trump. Think Progress has done a study. It's out this week. There are 180 members of Congress who are climate change deniers. All of them are Republican. 180 members of Congress are climate change deniers. They are all Republican. And guess what? They've all received a total of $82 million from the fossil fuel industries. Isn't that interesting? We talked about this last week, about how people are just paid to lie. Even though we know it's not true, they will lie for a price. And Think Progress has a study out that shows that the 180 members of Congress, all Republican, who deny the science behind climate change, they are on the take. They are receiving $82 million from fossil fuel industries. Meanwhile, 2017 is turning out to be the second warmest year on record. Last year, the Earth reached record levels of carbon dioxide, but we still have Republicans willing to take money from the people who are heating up the planet. So nothing is being done, and so the flooding begins. 15-year-old Jordan Edwards, a young African-American, was killed by police Saturday night in Balch Springs. That's a suburb of Dallas, Texas. According to the Washington Post, 15-year-old Jordan Edwards is now the 105th black person to be killed by police in the United States this year. 15-year-old Jordan Edwards was at a party. He was sitting in a car unarmed with his brother and friends. According to reports, there was no fighting, no drinking. None of the car's other occupants were arrested. The identity of the officer who killed him is unknown. Donald Trump was interviewed by CBS's John Dickerson in the Oval Office on Monday. Dickerson asked Trump about whether or not he believed Obama tapped his phones and whether or not Trump still believed that Obama was mentally unbalanced. Dickerson asked, do you stand by that claim? And Trump said, I don't stand by anything. You can take it the way you want. I think our side's been proven very strongly and everybody's talking about it. Dickerson pressed. He said, do you stand by your claims that Obama tapped your phone and that he's insane? And Trump replied, I don't stand by anything. And this interview is over. Big tough guy in the Oval Office literally then went back to his desk and wouldn't talk to anybody because, you know, he's a spoiled baby. So later on in the day, there was a press conference. Sean Spicer was then asked by a reporter, quote, the president said, I don't stand by anything. How is the American public supposed to digest that? You know, how are we supposed to trust what the president says when he himself says of his own comments, I don't stand by anything? Sean Spicer replied, I think the point is he clearly stands by that. That's something that's been made very clear if you look at the entire back and forth exchange between John Dickerson. Spicer is saying when Donald Trump says, I don't stand by anything, we stand by that. Coming up, Colleen Werthmann, Liam McEneaney, My Lunch, Eddie Pepitone, and Professor Corey Brettschneider.
Put on my headphones here.
I have a joke about that, but you'll get mad.
I'm sure it's hacky as hell. Let me guess. It's like, what do we want? A cure for Tourette's. When do we want it? Cunt! That's like a classic.
No. Are we rolling?
We're rolling.
I was going to say, can we talk about this?
Sure.
Well, you know somebody who's going to Spain.
Yes. My husband, Gardner Comfort. He's going over Memorial Day weekend.
To talk about.
He's doing a TEDx talk in Madrid. That's Madrid to all of you ignoramuses. about having Tourette's. About,
right.
You know, being part of a community that has its own understandings.
Right. And I was just thinking, as you said that to me, it must be difficult to have Tourette's in Spain if you don't speak Spanish, because how can you blurt out
obscenities?
In,
oh, boy.
Puta? Would that help him?
But isn't a real thing, right?
Well, it is. It's called coprolalia.
Mm-hmm. Copra what?
Coprolalia.
C-O-P-R-O.
C-O-P-R-O-L-A-L-I-A.
Hmm.
But only like 10% of people with Tourette's actually have that manifestation.
And the other 90% fake it.
No. It's, well, the one that is more mysterious is the one that involves like social taboo words. Like some people with Tourette's will say the N-word or say like fat bitch or stuff like that. It, because there's like some sort of neurological Venn diagram between like socially inappropriateness and anxiety and language. And so they'll blurt out the thing that they don't want to say. It's like Tourette's is just really trippy. It's like a cosmic joke that is being played on your body by your own self all the time.
Robin Williams told me that when he was making Awakenings with Oliver Sacks, who wrote the...
Right, the man who mistook his wife for a hat.
Right.
That he got in an elevator because they were shooting at a hospital and there was a woman who had Tourette's.
Mm-hmm.
And he gets into the elevator and it stops on one floor and a big, fat black man
mm-hmm.
walks in and he starts staring at her mm-hmm. like, no don't mm-hmm. don't
right
and she did.
Yeah, I mean those are like the fun theatrical kinds of tics that like people love to make jokes about and like right. and like I get it
right.
I personally don't find it hilarious because I just live with most of the time just like the actually hard stuff about Tourette's, which right. is that people treat my husband like he's mentally ill or turn around with like super intense anger anytime we go to see a movie or see a play or, you know, like we're lying in bed trying to go to sleep at night and his body is thrashing and it's like really exhausting and hard. So I have a much more...
I have to say I have a friend who has Tourette's
mm-hmm.
and I didn't know it at first.
Yeah.
So there's like, and she's, her, the way hers manifests is like she sniffs a lot,
yep.
like very deeply
mm-hmm.
and continually. So the first time I was hanging out with a bunch of people and I just left, I just walked out because I was just like, God, this woman won't, thank God I didn't hand her a tissue or tell her to blow her nose.
Mm-hmm.
But I just walked out and then a friend, I was talking to a friend like, God, can you believe this? And then he was like, no, she's got Tourette's.
Yeah, because a lot of times tics are like normal things. Like my husband has one where he goes, and it sounds like he's clearing his throat or coughing.
Right.
And so like almost every day, if he has to take the subway that day, which he totally hates because like
right.
people give him dirty looks and whatever, he'll come home and he'll have this little handful of lozenges in his jeans pocket and he'll put them on the nightstand. Or on our dresser, and it's
wow.
yeah.
That's you know. I'm sorry. I'm laughing. That is a little bit funny.
Well, no, but hang on.
No, I mean it is.
It like, is funny.
It's a human impulse to
right.
You know, try to correct the thing that's annoying you, and also to help people.
Right.
Sometimes at the same time, which often that gesture is.
Plus, give a little bit of a passive aggressive like
yeah.
I'd like you to stop that now.
Right.
Right. Exactly.
Because I like just my I have an itchy throat mm-hmm. last year. I just my allergies have made that.
Mm-hmm.
And I always find that I have to clear my throat when I'm walking behind someone on the sidewalk. Like it never fails. The only time I have to really clear my throat is when someone's walking in front of me. And I've learned to disguise it as a sneeze or a cough.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you go, then they will turn around and assume that you're being like a shitty passive-aggressive person.
Right.
So I can't imagine that's your life, like all day long. You're on the subway.
Yeah.
There's some dude. You clear your throat, you know, and they turn and they're like, well, what the fuck is this guy's? Would you fucking clean your throat at me, buddy?
Yeah. Yeah, or are you coughing? Are you, like, sneezing on me? Because
right.
sometimes he'll go, like he makes this explosive noise slash movement through his nose, like a breath movement. It's not even a breath. It's just like a kind of
right
short, sharp expression. I don't know how else this gets like that specific and that difficult to describe. But people think he's like snotting on them.
Mm-hmm.
You know? It's weird. It's trippy.
Well, it's great to see you guys.
It's great to see you, too.
Oh, hi.
Enough about my husband's neurological disorder. How are you?
Welcome to the show.
David, I haven't seen you since we made America Great Again.
Yes, we did. Can you get... Let me introduce... Don't touch the microphone.
I. You know what? I'm going to adjust the microphone during the show.
What, we got Gigi Allen over here?
I am going to throw shit at you guys over the course of the show.
Who's Gigi Allen?
Oh, he was this really insane.
Jesus Christ.
I can't believe you don't know who Gigi Allen is. I feel like he would be right up your alley in terms of people to know about.
And it's the world's greatest music reference if you have to make a joke about punk rock, especially.
Okay.
Yeah. So he was this really self-destructive and outwardly destructive punk alleged musician who would like cut himself with broken bottles and like shit. Uh-huh. In his own hands and like fling it at the audience.
You mean I'm a musician?
Yeah, apparently so.
He also,
you should have had a like little duo together.
He had a band called the Murder Junkies.
Yes.
And they were called that because they were junkies and they shot up together. Mm. And so it was like everything that you think about a hard partying early death rock and roll lifestyle. Gigi Allen lived it. He was covered in tattoos. He was a maniac.
Did he live?
No,
he's
dead. He's dead.
He died youngish.
He played right in this neighborhood.
Yeah,
like this was his stomping grounds. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, there was a big shooting gallery a few blocks down from here. He would hang out there, and then there were a bunch of just tiny little DIY venues all over this neighborhood where he would just go up and set fire to things.
Yep.
And, you know, it was
people.
No, he would throw chairs at the audience. It was you only went if you were really angry. And you really just wanted to be part of something that manifested your anger to society.
And the music, are there albums that you can listen to? And it's
all over Spotify. I'll tell you what, I'll give you $10 if you make it all the way through one.
There's a documentary about him. What is it called? Like,
I haven't seen it.
It's called like Twisted or something like that, but that's not the word.
Gigi Allen?
Yeah, but it's A-L-L-I-N.
Ah.
G-period, A-L-L-I-N. I like spelling things.
So, let me introduce everybody.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough.
That was the voice of Colleen Werthmann,
Hi.
Who is back in New York, thank God.
And yay.
She was living in L.A. for a while.
Yep.
We hung out in L.A. one night.
We did.
And that is Liam McInerney.
McEneaney.
Liam McInerney, author of Bright Cities, Bright Lights.
Big Lights. Bright Cities.
Bright City, Big Lights.
You say it's McEneaney.
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 You keep changing it on me.
No, you just apparently don't care to remember how to pronounce my name correctly.
Well, I haven't seen you in a while. You kind of left me.
I left Los Angeles. I left you.
Oh, boy.
Dude, you were one of the last few things keeping me in New York City. Like, there was just a point where...
All right, I lied. I wasn't pregnant.
So... Then why did I pay $600 for that abortion, David? God damn it. Please, you know, the second time, shame on me.
See, that's why she's a head writer of a show. Like when she takes it there.
I got hot bort jokes.
What is a hot bort joke?
Hot bort. Like a bort.
Oh, I thought, so that's sort of like what a head writer says. A hot board, like it goes up on the board.
Oh, no.
We have to get it on the show, so.
I got a hot board joke.
I like it.
David, you haven't worked in a while, huh?
Let's create a new term for writing. That's a hot board joke.
Then a bort.
No, a hot board joke.
No, yeah. I like hot bort joke, because then you're like, well, we can't do that, but it's a hot board joke.
Yeah. We could have both.
Yeah.
Why not both?
Okay. Because I feel like this is, you know how like at some point a son's just got to battle his father for supremacy?
Indeed.
That's what's going on today.
Oh, okay. Well, like, are we both the son?
No, I'm fighting David to take over.
Do you see me as a father figure?
No.
You know what? I see you as
Nor do I see you as anything else for that matter.
No, I definitely don't see you as an authority in any way whatsoever.
Oh, okay.
But I see you as like a comedy uncle. Like, I would say that. Like, you're an older person who has a career that I, you know, aspire to be somewhat like.
You know, so you respect me?
No, but I just, you somehow...
Do you look up to me when you're blowing me and make
eye contact? You somehow, like,
sorry.
Despite your...
Why are you apologizing to me?
Because it was a bad joke.
It was a bort joke.
I don't want to get into that.
Then,
I don't want to be like the Judge Judy of this podcast.
Okay. No, put that into the Bort joke file. That was a hot Bort joke.
Yep.
Not a hot.
But it's not even a Bort. It's not even Bort level. That's just joke. That's
a BJ joke. Do you look up to me? Do you make eye contact when you're blowing me?
Well, you would know that, wouldn't you?
If he's
should know that.
That would get you a
as
one...
the blowee. That's the least you could do.
No, no, I definitely see David as the guy who, like, puts his hands behind his back and, like, closes his eyes like he's, like, the fucking Shah. Like, in his tent in the desert, like...
On my peacock throne.
So, David, I haven't seen you in 7 months. Are you getting laid?
Are you getting your dick wet?
Are you catching any strange?
Are you hitting that nani?
Are you getting any ass?
Are you tapping any tail?
I don't understand the question.
Basically, are you having sex with women?
Are you inserting your penis into any women's vaginas?
Consensually.
Yeah. Or non-consensually.
See, that's a hot board joke right there.
Define female. Human? Human?
You know what? As long as she...
Does a trash can count as female?
Technically, a female cat has a vagina, so yes. No, but seriously, are you dating David? Like, are you seeing anybody?
I'm not going to discuss my...
Why not? But that's what we want to know.
Yeah, like,
I came here all the way from Harlem. I took the 4 train and it went local, sir.
And you know what? I came here from Los Angeles to ask you about your dating life.
I feel like that's the least you could do.
Well,
that's the bare minimum.
I want to spare you.
Have you noticed that all the big podcasts are the ones where the hosts kind of open up about their lives and, you know, like let the listener
take
in a little bit.
Take a page from that concept.
Yeah, like WTF with Marc Maron. You know, man, like, you know, so let's...
Well, would it help the podcast if I was getting laid?
And this would be an actually interesting thing to know from a host.
Yeah. We will talk about your cats a little bit later in the podcast, David, but...
Yeah.
Are you least going
are
on first dates?
Are you courting any ladies?
Yes.
Okay. How many?
When you
do
say
they know about each other?
Courting, going to, you know, divorce is in a court...
Don't give me your pun bullshit. What is this? Wait, wait, don't tell me? Fuck
I just
you.
Listened to Wait, Wait, Tell Me today. It was
Why?
Excellent. It was excellent.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
Speaking of which, so how many ladies are you dating right now?
Yeah.
I'm
going to say 2 and you're playing them off each other.
No, I would say 2 and they don't know about each other. That's my guess. I would say David's probably one of those guys that, like, sees a woman for a few months, but he's still on Tinder looking for other women, like that kind of guy.
Wait, but that's technically only dating one person and then just Tindering.
No, because the first few months, in my opinion, are not a relationship. That's like anything goes. You can see other people. It's when you kind of agree within that 3 to 6 month period when you're like, you kind of like, oh, well, we have feelings about each other. Let's make this exclusive.
Mm-hmm.
That's when it's a relationship. But I feel like David is probably... In his mind, at least, in the zone where he can see more than one person and it's okay.
Right, but again, on the technical tip, dating one person while just swiping through Tinder, that's just dating one person.
Well, first of all,
if we're talking about results, one person.
I don't think David really knows how to use Tinder, so I was just using that as an
example.
Obviously,
he's not using Tinder.
Right. He's obviously going, like, you know, he's hanging out after a show and talking to young women who thought the show was funny and just like, hey, if you want to get together and write some jokes, I'll definitely help you out.
I don't see David as, like, a young gal cruiser. I feel like he's going to date people, like, his own age-ish or maybe slightly younger, but, like, he's not going to go, like, after 25-year-olds. His daughter is 25, and that would skeeve him out too much. Am I right, David?
Mm-hmm. But the thing is, there are a lot of women in their late 30s who think they're going to make it in comedy if they start now. They
God
have
bless.
No idea.
God bless.
God bless them. So,
and do they think...
God bless.
So David probably talks to them as like, hey, man, if you want to get together and write some jokes,
yeah,
I'd love to help you out.
37 is still too young for him.
Really, David? 37's too young? What's your age range?
I'm listening. This is interesting. No.
You got to get in it. You have to answer before we
okay,
can go
Okay, I'll
on.
Answer your questions if I want to. Go ahead.
What is your age range?
I enjoy being around women who are my age.
Okay, so what is that 70? Age range?
I would say early 10
on
to
either
mid-50s.
Side?
Early to mid-50s.
Okay.
Because as Bob Saget said, I can take you to the morgue and we can open up some drawers and we can put some on the marble slab for you to take a look at. That's what Saget said to me when I told him I'm attracted to women my own age. He said, are they still alive?
Mm-hmm.
Because he can't imagine.
You know what the thing
is? That guy really as gross as he wants everyone to think he is?
He's not gross. He's a wonderful man.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like everyone's always like, oh, his comedy's so outrageous.
Alex, and
I'm like, is this?
Make a note. I want to ask David about that off air and see what he says.
What? Interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
Interesting.
I feel like there's a little bit of insincere.
About what?
About Saget.
Oh, no. I love Bob.
Okay.
But is he as, like, is his lifestyle as grody as he wants
he's not
everyone?
Not at all. Not at all. He's a hopeless romantic.
Interesting.
Yeah. And he treats women with respect. The only way you can make those kind of jokes is if nobody has anything on you.
Interesting.
That is true.
That
is true. Like, you know, once you become that guy, mm-hmm. people don't want it. It's not funny anymore.
It's got to be, you have to.
Like, once Dice Clay became that guy, it just didn't become funny uh-huh. anymore. So people were like, oh, well, he actually hates women.
Right.
But then what about, like, say, like a Jim Norton who, you know, makes a lot of hay out of, like, oh, I have sex with, you know, trans women. I am such a gross, weird pervert. But he seems like he actually is.
Well, he is. But you can't have anything on a guy like that because he'll be honest about it and he'll be the first one to cop to it.
Does that make it less funny?
Is there... there's probably something he won't tell us, right? When people say they're an open book, they're really... But let's go back to my dating life.
Okay.
I just want to finish this thought. I think mm-hmm. you're right that David likes to age-appropriate women. I believe you. But I think he likes the ones that do yoga and keep in really good shape. Like, I don't think you like a mess.
A mess. To describe a human being as a mess.
I mean, David is a fairly, you know, conscientious person who,
right.
you know, you always have a nice shirt on. But
you notice all those guys in L.A. date yoga women who keep themselves in really good shape.
Well, are there any non-yoga women? I didn't see any.
Yeah, there are a ton of them.
I was living in an Airbnb in West Hollywood, so it was sort of a self-selecting community of sort of...
Right. It was gay men and women in really good shape who want to be around gay men.
Right.
And, you know, I think that's David's type. It's like a, you know...
Women who are very comfortable around gay men. Yes, that seems to be my type.
But that actually is a good sign sometimes.
Right.
Because there's a certain kind of woman who only hangs around with gay men because she's afraid of actually experiencing intimacy with heterosexual men mm-hmm. and also feels like no one will ever no hetero man will ever understand me or I can have, you know, it's a safety mechanism. And then there's heterosexual women who hang around gay men because they're like, can be raunchy and have fun.
Right.
That's mm-hmm. Those are two different things. They're not necessarily mutually exclusive, but they are two qualitative distinctions worth acknowledging.
You know what always made me uncomfortable was like heterosexual women who call men my gay.
Oh, it's...
It's just like really weird and possessive and...
Gross.
I don't know why it offends me, but it offends me.
Well, you're identifying somebody by their sexuality.
You wouldn't say my black...
Well, not in front of them.
Well, but then what?
His father owned a plantation.
Oh,
that's not funny, David. We lost a lot of money.
Your middle name is Beauregard?
Well, I do declare.
That's why you're always putting your thumbs in your suspenders.
I wish I was in the land of cotton. Old times they are not forgotten.
Yuck.
If you were born,
gross,
Colleen.
If
I were born.
If you were born,
big if.
If you weren't a hot pork joke,
1848, you're born in Georgia. You're now it's 1860.
I'm sneering as I'm hearing this.
And your father owns a plantation. And you're
my now dad.
Yeah,
is there with me?
Yeah,
this is getting too complicated.
Well, she'd be 34 at that point.
I can't do the math. Let's just say you were born into a plantation, and
white or black.
She's white.
Okay, she's white.
Well, how was I to assume that?
Yeah, okay. Don't assume her color.
And so now you've got the hoop skirt or with the hoop dress or whatever they wore back then.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, mammy.
Okay, let's get to the end.
Would you rebel against daddy say this is wrong or would you go along with it?
Look, in real life, in the 20th century, my own grandfather was drafted into the Nazi army. So I don't have a lot of historical maybe scruples on which to stand here, okay? Who can say? Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. The person I am now is certainly not the person I would have turned out to be if I were just like born into the world then. Like everyone's like, oh, never again. That could never happen again. Of course, anything could happen always again.
You know, it's interesting.
And will.
I was really curious about how ordinary Germans got into the whole Nazi thing. Because, mm-hmm. you know, like, you understand.
Super incrementally, like over many years.
I read a great book about it. I wish I could remember the name of
Explaining Hitler by Ron Rosenbaum?
No, it's something else. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe. But it was just about life in Germany before and during Nazi Germany. And basically, it was just like, you know, like, nobody wanted their kids to be part of the Hitler Youth. It's just... summer camp was such a big part of the German lifestyle at mm-hmm. that time. And eventually the Nazis just took over those youth camps
yeah.
and made it the Hitler Youth camps. And so
yeah,
it was
my
like,
dad did Hitler Youth.
So you had... Your dad?
Yeah. I mean, like, everyone was in it who...
Hmm. Well, that's it. It's like, so basically your choice was...
He said it was the funnest camp.
You
would, like, milk campfires and, like, go
hiking.
There were
camps in Germany that were a lot more fun. But.
Oh, I know. I mean, I could go on and on, David. I could go on and on.
But the thing was, you had a choice. No one was forced to join Hitler Youth. It was just, like, it's either that or have no friends. You know, like, right. all your friends were going to camp, because as they always did, as their fathers did, and so
yeah,
on.
Yeah, he
so
was
forth.
Like, if you wanted to have, like, eat breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and campfire, because everyone, you know, because whatever, it was wartime.
Right.
You would go and, like, be in Hitler Youth. And if, like, you get to sing all the campfire songs, and then at the end you have to say Heil Hitler? He was like, so we said Heil Hitler.
I was in Berlin. I heard an amazing story. This woman had an elderly neighbor who lived through the war.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, you know, all the soldiers kind of came home one night, and then the Russians invaded the mm-hmm. next day. And so all the commanding officers were told to get their guys out of their homes and lead them against the Russians. And he said instead, he just told everybody, take off your uniforms, you know, hide them, and just take care of your family until this is over.
Mm.
She said, like, a bomb fell into their apartment, like, through the roof of their apartment building, and two guys had to come with blankets and take it to the river and you know, like, detonate it there.
Really?
Whoa.
I wonder if we should get our money back for a bomb that didn't go off.
But maybe it was a Russian bomb.
Oh, okay. So your father was in Hitler Youth.
Yeah.
And so when the war was over, how old was he?
13.
He was 13.
Wait, really?
Mm-hmm.
How old is he now? Is he still with us?
He's 81.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Are there any fond memories the Hitler Youth camps? Does he have any fond memories of Hitler or anything that was joyous?
No, he's very, he jokingly, bitterly refers to his childhood as the good old days.
My son is in Berlin now.
Is he?
Yep, learning fluent. He's already fluent in German.
Wow.
Lucky
what neighborhood
man.
Is he living in?
I don't know. He showed me a FaceTime video. It was beautiful.
Uh-huh. Oh, Berlin is incredibly beautiful.
I you know yeah. what? I almost moved there. I still kind of regret not moving there about 10 years ago.
Because
it was just, it's just such an easy place to live, and it's not expensive.
If you're an artist, you are fucking psyched.
Yeah.
To live in Berlin.
And then I could just go and do gigs from Berlin and use that as my home base.
He says there's a comedy scene
there's
there.
There's now a big
huge comedy,
comedy
scene.
They
yeah.
speak English. Mm-hmm. The whole, he said that there's a deal that they're offering young people because they have a demographic problem.
Right.
Everybody is.
And I'm 29, so I'm listening.
Everybody's too old in Germany. They need young people. That's why they let the refugees in, because somebody's got to keep the engine going
right.
to pay for the safety net. And the deal is they will pretty much give him citizenship if he learns to speak German. So he's
You have to do that in order to actually qualify for German jobs.
Right.
You have to take this exam. There's actually a big article about it in the Times yesterday.
So it is the official language of Germany.
I don't know if it's official, but the government definitely is like, you have to be proficient in this language.
Yes. I looked into emigrating there.
Yet he says everybody there speaks English.
Yeah, because you learn it starting in, like, first grade.
I think English has become the lingua franca.
Well, no, German is definitely still the lingua franca.
Well, you know, I found...
But it's polite.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, there's the stereotype, right. like, when you go to France, that people are like, ugh,
right.
if they have to speak English to you. The exact opposite is true in Germany. It's considered polite. If, like, one person, English is their first language, that you all speak English.
Hmm. When I was performing there, I performed in English. You know, like, it was just... And I found it was the same thing as when I performed in the South, which is I slowed down a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody is following along at the same pace.
Yep.
And told anti-Semitic jokes. Same thing as the South.
I actually have a friend in Germany who's an older German comic. And whenever we hang out, it's all Holocaust jokes. Mm-hmm. And at first it was upsetting.
Does he make them?
He makes nothing but Holocaust jokes.
That's interesting because I asked my son about that. And he said he can make them, but they don't do it.
Yeah, well, it's a little too...
I think it's the brotherhood of comedians, David.
It's also generational, too. This generation is either super lefty and like trying really hard to be progressive and like accepting and whatever. Mm-hmm. And also there's like another stripe that's very resentful of having been born into all this baggage.
Right.
You know.
And the other thing is, so the older generation, like probably around your father's age, never talked about the war, never talked about the Holocaust.
Exactly.
And then the generation after them were very much about being open about it, because that was still when the wall was up.
Yeah.
And so now you have the generation that's just like, just dealing with this fucking emotional baggage that's been handed down for the last
years. My son said, they love the Jews here. And I said, give it time.
Well, it's because they don't know any.
There actually has been sort of a Jewish repopulation of at least East Berlin.
Right.
Which was a hugely Jewish city at the time. I mean, like a quarter of the residents, at least, I think, were Jewish during the Second World War. But like,
they have rented Jew now in Germany.
Sweet. For rent for what?
There's
like if you need a movie produced or if you need some banking advice.
There's a service.
Boy, I bet those camps are closed now because they knew where to find them then.
There's actually rented Jew in Germany because a lot
Is this a Lenny Bruce bit?
No, it's real. In fact, I was telling my son to hire yourself out as a Jew because they bring Jews into somebody's home for a fee and they answer questions because a lot of Germans don't know what a Jew is.
Right.
I consider them lucky, but they want to learn. And for a small fee, a Jew will come in.
Show off their horns.
Talk very loud. Lend money at exorbitant interest rates.
Right. And complain about bagels.
And complain about how you can't get a good bagel. And there's something about the Rhine water that makes it...
It's the spray in Berlin, actually.
They invite a Jew into their home, and then the Jew evicts them.
What is the river?
It's called the Spree, S-P-R-E-E.
So there's no Rhine? Where's the Rhine?
The Rhine is in West Germany.
Ah, and where's Elba? No, not the Elba.
Elba was the Star of the Wire.
That's where Napoleon
was. There's the Elba.
I'm talking about Idris Elba, which is Alex got that.
Right, right.
Alex Brazell, your producer, got that.
Brian Colley, the comedy writer.
Mm-hmm.
Great comedy writer, great comedian.
Head monologue writer for Conan.
And
has been with the show since the very beginning.
Before Conan, he was writing on Conan.
Yeah.
He's BC.
He's BC when it was just Late Night with Conan O'Brien.
No, before Conan O'Brien even...
Wait, why are we talking about him all of a sudden?
Because his father was in D-Day.
Okay.
And invaded Germany.
I feel like everybody says their parents were in D-Day.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like, oh, my grandpa liberated Auschwitz. It's like, really? Did 55,000 soldiers really liberate Auschwitz? Because there was like 20 soldiers there.
A lot of these guys are getting...
None of my family went.
A lot of these guys are getting older. And my father used to say, not only was he at D-Day, but he saw Joe Cocker sing. Dad, that's Woodstock. Everybody was at Woodstock.
Right, everyone was at Woodstock, and everybody was at D-Day.
So my great uncle was at Pearl Harbor when it was bombed, but his name's on the wall. Like, we can prove it.
Very good.
Yashimoto Hirasaki. So
Colleen didn't like that. Colleen did not like that joke.
I was trying to see if I could make a tag, and then I was just like, I got nothing.
So Brian,
it was perfectly fine.
Brian Kiley's father, D-Day.
Mm-hmm.
And liberated parts.
I don't think it's funny the way you're making fun of stutterers right now. Just say day.
Doris D-Day was one of my favorite singers. The movies she made with...
You know, Double D-Day when Playboy was founded.
All right. So Brian Kiley's father...
Well, does that mean that Jugs was founded on G-Day?
So let me start again.
Okay, Joe Cocker.
Oh, we're still on this?
Brian Kiley's father.
I'm already exhausted.
Right. Brian Kiley's father liberated Germany.
Right.
during World War II.
Mm-hmm.
Or WW2 for you stutterers.
I have a feeling it's going to be a long walk to the end of this pier.
Actually, the sad part is he sexually liberated Germany.
So he was willing to go to some extremes.
It was 1967.
The Germans
it was
are very kinky. Very kinky people.
Oh, yeah. He was a lot. It was very wet. Very hot.
So Brian Kiley.
So about your dating life, David. That's
Brian. Yeah, speaking of which.
Brian Kiley.
Oh, my God. Brian Kiley. Brian Kiley. Brian Kiley.
Brian Kiley.
The great Brian Kiley. Oh.
Oh, a legendary writer.
Brian Kiley's father.
Do you have like a neurological disorder where you can't sleep
at
night?
Talking about Brian Kiley?
Like you can't sleep at night if you don't finish this story. Like in the middle of the night, you're going to wake up, Brian Kiley's father. Fuck. Alex, get in the studio.
So Brian Kiley writes for Conan. He's been on Letterman.
I'm in physical pain.
One of the best comedy writers in television and just a great comic.
Mm-hmm.
And his father liberated the Germans from during World War II.
Right. By killing
liberated
them.
The Germans from World War II?
Yes.
By killing them. But he liberated them from breathing and you know, having families and seeing their children again. That kind of thing. Really great guy.
He's part of the greatest generation.
Right, of murderers. Go ahead.
Battle of the Bulge.
Uh-huh. Yeah, well, tell me about it. Dude, after that election, I gained... I lost the Battle of the Bulge. We'll say that.
Anyway, so after World War II, he got married.
This is the father of Brian Kiley.
Yeah, and then Brian was born.
Wow, okay. Great story, man.
Okay.
Now I know how Brian was born. Can I call him and then
sounds
and
like Brian Kiley's dad got his dick wet.
Yeah, now, David. David.
Yeah, go ahead. What?
See, the harder he laughs at those jokes, right. The less he thinks he has to answer.
I know. Well, no,
I'm full court press.
So
it's
Brian, anyway, I'm telling it.
So does Brian know this story?
Yes, it's a great story. Brian.
Wow, that is a great story. His father got married and had a kid.
Now, what is the river called again? So I can get the punch.
The Spray.
No, but the other one, the Elbe.
The Elbe.
The Elbe.
And there's the Rhine. But are you talking about?
I'm trying to get to Brian Kiley's great story. About his father.
Is Brian here to tell
the story? Is so I can't give you the accurate German river.
Well, the punch.
How about the Mosel?
Is Brian coming in to tell this story?
No, I'm just.
Well, then why are you telling this story?
Because it's a great story. There's a river called Mosel in Germany. There's a river called Mosel.
Yeah, Mosel. It's where a lot of the Riesling wines.
I know of them.
Yeah, a lot of them are made along the Mosel River.
But there's a Mosel in Iraq.
No, that's Mosul. This is Mosel.
No. Oh. Did you know that Brian Kiley's father is a war hero?
I know that I'm about to kill myself.
Colleen's about to liberate this conversation.
I'm liberating myself from breathing.
All right, so he sprayed all over the Germans.
Let me just get this story. So
Busted a nut.
Okay, busted a nut.
So Pearl Harbor happened December
7th. Pearl
7th.
What?
Harbor.
Oh, I went to fucking Pearl Harbor. Fucking bam those Japs.
Well, Brian's father was from Boston, as a matter of fact.
I know. I was doing a hilarious Boston accent.
So December 7th, 1941, a day that will live.
In infamy.
Mm-hmm.
So
I think this conversation.
It will live in infamy.
I'm telling Brian's story.
How much longer is it? Just, how much longer is it?
How soon until it's over? It's an interesting story.
Okay, how long is it though?
See, it's a very short.
Remember when that man harassed you about how long and boring your podcast was, and you told him you could have the fast forward mechanism? I'm going to fast forward to the end where you tell the joke.
You know, Colleen, I don't know about you. This is why I can't have a kid.
Yeah.
Because the minute that kid came home from school and started telling a fucking 20-minute story about some bug he saw in the schoolyard after school, I'd be like, no. I'm going to teach you a little something about getting to the punchline.
Yep. Yeah, or like when kids make up just like bullshit out of their imagination. Uh-huh. They're like, and you know what? Because the tree wanted to stand by the fire hydrant and be an ant, and also then Superman was there. I'm like, no.
Oh, it's a good thing I love my nephew.
I was like, you're losing me.
If I did not love my nephew, I would never see him because I would be like, come back when you're 18 and have a formed personality.
Yeah. You know what? Let's try to craft this narrative a little more sharply.
So this is what Dave is doing with this story about Brian Kiley's father.
He's got like, the ant, he's got the fire hydrant, he's got Superman.
So Brian Kiley, right? He has a father, right? And his father got married and had kids, and he went to Germany, and he liberated him?
It's a brief story.
How necessary was the detail?
How allegedly brief it?
I have to know. How necessary was the detail that he then got married and had Brian?
Okay,
seems superfluous.
Does that bring us to the point? Is that part of the thing where Brian is like, just in case you didn't know, I was born.
Liam, should you and I be teaching essay writing to high schoolers?
To David.
All right. So long story short. The Japanese.
I give this essay an F.
The Japanese.
Minus.
In fact, I'm going to need to see your parents, David, because quite frankly,
after class.
When is parent teacher day? Because quite frankly, this story is bullshit. Right.
So the Japanese.
And it's not even your story.
David is an exceedingly bright young man.
No, he's not.
He has a wonderful creativity and often seeks unusual solutions to fairly straightforward problems. However, he has a tendency to monopolize class conversation.
You know what my teacher said on my report card? Plays well with others, if by others you mean penis. We wish he could stop.
Hey-o, ladies and gentlemen.
So, anyway. So, hey-o. The Japanese attack Pearl Harbor.
Those dirty yellow
Japs.
Wait,
how are they related to Brian Kiley?
Because what happened after Pearl Harbor was...
Yes, my uncle died in Pearl Harbor.
Really?
Yes. Yeah, his plaque is on the wall.
Yeah, my great-uncle Don, Nair.
Don?
N-E-H-E-R.
I got all excited because I thought he invented the Nair hair removal.
No, but apparently my great-grandfather had a neighbor named Mr. Gillette who offered to let him invest $500 in his new safety razor company.
Oh, that story. I've heard that story 100 times.
Yeah, you know what? My family has a version of that, too, where my great-aunt Marge Donahue was friends with the Crocs in Florida, right. And they were like, hey,
we're building crock pots.
We're going to make...
We have this new thing called a crock
David,
pot.
David, I'm telling a story.
See, you would make a good mom.
I'd be a mean mom.
I would be the dad.
I'd be the mean mom that, like, they didn't would love daddy better.
I would be the fun dad because I would be gone most of the time. Mm-hmm. But the time I was there, I'd be like, hey, we're going to Disneyland. Okay, now I'm going to let your mom raise you.
So they had an opportunity to invest in McDonald's.
Yeah, he was like, I'm going to make a hamburger restaurant that's like a drive-thru, only you go inside.
Uh-huh.
Or something like that. Oh, no. He was like, it's going to be a hamburger restaurant, but you can drive through in your car. And Marge Donahue was apparently like, Ray, that's a terrible idea. Who would want to eat a meal in their car? Allegedly.
Allegedly.
Mm. Well, my mother used to date a guy named Ken Lay.
Of Lay's potato chips?
No, from Enron. And Ken.
Oh, Ken Lay.
Yeah, and Ken gave her. She was my mom is great.
Wait, is this for real?
This is true. My mom is great in bed. And Ken Lay.
Ken was getting his dick wet.
Ken Lay.
Speaking of which, David, so are you... So
hang on, Ken Lay said...
Are you dating anybody?
He said, was so good, I'm going to give you stock in Enron. And my mother sold it. And I'd hate to think if she had held on to that Enron stock, what it'd be worth today.
Wait, the Lay pun inside that Enron
because the guy
story,
who ran,
chilling though it was.
Because the guy who ran Enron was named Ken Lay.
Yeah, but then you said that was such a great Lay. You made like a Lay.
A lame, pun. Yeah. Anyway, so back to Brian Kiley's story.
Well, you know, the thing is, when my great uncle died at Pearl Harbor, all the family members were offered $10,000 by the government, but only my... My uncle took them up on it.
Really?
He started a business with it, and the rest of the family held it against him because they
said like, it was blood money?
Yeah, it was blood money. They didn't want to touch it.
And that business was Xerox.
Dude, if I was in talking terms with my uncle who ran Xerox, I would definitely not be here right now. I'd be on an island.
My grandfather died at Pearl Harbor. You know what his last words were?
Glub, glub. That's my Whitney Houston punchline. What were Whitney Houston's last words? Glub, glub.
So, anyway, so the Nazis...
David died at Pearl Harbor, but there's a comedy club there now. It's a whole other...
So the Nazis, without America...
Oh, the story's still going on.
Okay, oh, my good. God.
But Hitler declared war on America after Pearl Harbor.
Right.
America wasn't going to go fight Hitler until Hitler declared war. So Brian's father joined up to liberate the Germans from the Germans.
Mm-hmm.
And was in the Battle of the Bulge.
Mm-hmm.
So 50 years later, Brian's father is vacationing in Florida, and he meets a young German, because Germans like to visit Florida.
Uh-huh.
Why, to see lots of Jews, like in the olden days? Germans don't like Florida. They like Texas.
They go to Germany. No, for real.
No, the Irish like Florida.
No, the Germans like Florida.
No, the Irish like Florida.
They don't know what an old Jew looks like.
Okay. Better.
No, Colleen, I'm just
better
letting
than
this,
my joke.
You know, I'm letting this ride because I really would love to just get on with life.
I really want to find out who David is dating. I need to find out
Brian's
more about
father,
dating life.
Brian's father goes to Florida. He meets a young German.
He meets a young German.
And the young German says to Brian's father, "Brian's father, have you been to Germany?" And Brian's father said, "I only got as far as the Elbe." That's pretty funny.
I don't know.
I don't understand that joke.
It was a joke about how far his infantry unit got during the World War II.
Did you get that joke from Humor in Uniform from Reader's Digest?
Well, when Brian Kiley tells it, it's hysterical.
Well, Brian's funny.
I don't know, maybe I am experiencing
such a profound sense of disillusionment and disappointment.
You know, this reminds me of the story.
The best part of that joke was because they'd never seen old Jews.
Well, it was the journey.
This reminds me.
No,
you know
what? It most assuredly was not the journey.
Wait a second.
This reminds me of my grandfather. Hang on for one second.
Right. Fuck Brian Kiley. I don't give a shit about him.
Fuck Brian Kiley.
I like Brian Kiley a lot.
Kill Brian Kiley.
No, I like Brian Kiley a lot.
That fucking story sucked.
Well, listen.
David, when you told that show. Fuck Brian Kiley.
When you told the story.
You ruined your
story. No, that's a shitty story.
It reminded me of when my father.
I'm pissed off at him now.
When my grandfather would tell stories, but after he had two strokes.
It's a two-stroke rule.
So, David, when you go, on a date, where do you take a lady?
Do you go out to dinner? Bingo.
Bingo. Take dinner.
Mm-hmm. Like, what kind of restaurant? What level? How much money?
Are we talking Asia to Cuba? No, never would you go to that restaurant.
What's that?
Oh, it's like a very overly designed, not very good restaurant that's sort of an Asian fusion mess like, where is it? Like Murray Hill or some nonsense.
I would say unless it has an early bird special, probably.
Are we talking, we're not going Boulay. That's too over the top.
What is Boulay? What's Boulay?
It's a restaurant in Tribeca.
Or Balthazar.
Like, Balthazar is like a good all-purpose restaurant.
How do you know these things?
Because we live in New York City.
Because I've lived here for fucking...
Yeah, I lived here for 40 years. I mean, 29 years.
Yeah, I've lived here for 28 years.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like you get to occasionally...
Go outside and do things.
You're like occasionally like, I'm going to spend money on my life.
Yeah.
And like do nice things that make me happy.
Yeah.
You know, like...
What does that mean?
Like tonight, I'm going to see a play.
Right.
With my husband. And I'm prepared for us to get dirty looks when he starts ticking and other people in the audience get mad.
But tonight I'm going to with some friends to see Fate of the Furious.
Very good.
And then I'm doing a show at QED at 11 o'clock.
Very good.
Okay.
So let me ask you something, David.
Yes, sir.
I think I made a mistake once. I met a woman I really liked. And I was like a little too fucking into impressing her. So I took her to a Broadway play because I was like, well, you know, she's just moved here from somewhere else. And so we went to the TKTS booth. And this is a good third date, I realized.
Wait, hang on. That's something I wouldn't do.
What, go to the TKTS
booth? That, I would, yeah, I'd have to know her for a while.
Well, I made the mistake. So I was like, I'll tell you what. We'll go to the TKTS booth. We'll pick a play that's on sale, and we'll just go.
Mm-hmm.
I went to see a musical, but it's like 4 hours of not talking to each other. It's like a really horrible way to get to know somebody.
Right.
Yeah. So,
but
yeah.
Also, 4 hours is like too long for a musical.
Well, 3 hours, whatever.
4 hours of not talking to each other.
3 hours, whatever.
You should, might as well get married.
Well, here's the thing, though.
I feel like you should send your listeners a David Feldman joke construction magnetic kit.
Yep.
And then everything would end with divorce or marriage.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or everybody is in a writing room, right, Colleen?
Everyone is not in a writing room, technically.
No, but in a writing room, the rule is gay or fat.
No, gay, I think, is out.
Well, no, you a thing. You were throwing shade, which is the gay show, so probably it was out at your show.
I think it's out in general.
Well, David's out in general.
I think that's a stale thing.
Like, see, I called him gay. That's pretty funny.
Yeah.
Because it's so shameful to be gay.
Right, you see, because...
Well, what were the room jokes? At throwing shade.
There were almost none. I mean, it was like a pretty like
professional operation.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you waste time?
We didn't.
But what kind of show is that?
A normal show where there's not a lot of extroverts. It was delightful.
Wait a second. Nobody was like on an assembly
doing
line
bits? No.
Blowing a guy?
No.
Nobody screamed at you about 9/11 for
no,
3 hours?
No, there were a lot of...
I had that.
Me too.
There were a lot of Kate Blanchett inside jokes, deep cuts. There were a lot of 70s cinema references.
Yeah, that's the gay show. That's the thing. Like, you probably...
It was gay men and women.
Yeah.
There's a show at the height of the Cosby revelations.
Mm-hmm.
There was a show, and the boss would call a meeting, a two-hour meeting every day,
uh-huh,
to talk about Cosby and make Cosby jokes. Had nothing to do with the show. But everybody had to go in and imitate Bill Cosby.
That sounds horrible.
That sounds hilarious.
It does sound kind of funny.
It was like the official Cosby meeting.
I'm just not into room bits. I
wait, so he would.
But what's the point of being a comedy writer if you're not into room bits? That's the whole point.
Well, that's for comedy performers.
But because the show is irrelevant. Oh, you were a head writer. You're a head writer.
You know the thing
that
was...
That doesn't mean anything, though.
You know what, David? When she was in the room,
I hate wasting time. I'm fucking right. German.
You're writing
like
for
television.
You're writing for television. You're already wasting time.
Yeah, but I like to waste time on my schedule.
You know what, David? Here's the thing. So, David, I can see it now. When she was in the room...
Here's what
it
I
was
am.
All work.
A disciplined writer who fucking gets shit done.
Yeah, so when she was...
That's not... What's the point?
No, you know what? You got corners right now. The corners of your mouth are turning up. So I know you're not even believing what you're saying
no,
right now. This is a pile of horse shit.
No,
you and I have both discussed off the air, yes, I'm blowing up your spot, about how there's tumblers and typers. How there's extroverts in the room who do room bits and da-da-da-da-da. How Mel Brooks on your show of shows was a tumbler. And then how there's typers.
And disliked.
Who are more
and disliked.
Yes. Because everyone else was a typer. An introvert who, you know,
right,
turns ideas and thoughts and words around in their minds.
Neil Simon.
Like a Rubik's Cube. You're Neil Simons.
But I told that
Woody
to you.
Allen.
I told that
Simons.
To you in privacy.
See,
I told that to you as a...
But I've told other people that, other comedy writers who I trust and like.
I confided in you.
You never told me that.
I told you two things not to tell anybody.
But it never came up between us, though.
I told you not to tell anybody about that person I murdered in Thailand.
Well, it was a hooker, so it's not really a person.
Well, that's...
I did tell.
Thank you for saying that, because I'm riven with guilt, and... That
dent you have from the ping pong ball ricocheting.
Technically, it was self-defense.
That forehead dent.
Your Honor.
That dent will never go away, so you've been punished enough. It clearly says, you know.
See, but I guarantee
Bangkok
you.
Bangkok Ping Pong Ball Manufacturing Co. Inc.
See, but
that's on you.
I guarantee you.
That's literally on you.
Colleen was the head writer where when she was in the room, it was all business and everyone got to work. And then as soon as she left, people were like, all right, now let's talk about what we watched last night.
Can I tell you? There were the hosts were very disciplined. I mean, it was like fucking breakneck making those episodes. It was a really, really small staff. We were just fucking cranking shit out all the time.
Mm.
And like, you know, we also didn't really know each other very well. I feel like you can do room bits once you have some familiarity or whatever.
What's the best room bit you ever heard, David?
The room bits, there was a guy named Jose Arroyo. We used to do room bits.
Great writer.
Yes.
Conan guy, too.
So when everybody was doing porn titles, there was a period, right? This was before Colleen was born, but everybody
It was definitely not, I assure you.
But there was a time, so I said, well, enough with the porn titles, and then I would
you
shout.
You did not say that.
Yes, I did.
And then you would shout out your own porn titles.
No, then I would say, I would say, okay, I want the titles of movies about dead babies.
Uh-huh.
And Jose Arroyo said, Dumb and Dumpster.
See, the look in Colleen's...
Not Dump and Dumpster?
Dumb and Dumpster. And that was the game we used to play on the show that I worked on. We would come up... I would usually be the one who would call out the... instead of a porn title, you had to come up with movie titles based on, you know, Holocaust themes, mm-hmm. and that kind of stuff. So
the look on Colleen's face is just like, that would not fly in my writing room.
I'm just like, my thing is, do you want to write? Like, why is everything a competition? Like, let's just fucking get things
That's
done
so we can go
home.
That's how efficient she is. She won't even say un.
No, I'll save a syllable. I don't give a fuck.
In fact, the leader of Korea just took that syllable. Mm.
That was a long walk at the end of that pier.
That sputtered worse than the last missile he fired.
Awful. Just.
I feel like this show just took a turn.
God bless this effort, but here's the thing. You want to assume that I'm not fun in a room.
I love you. I'm begging you to come here every day.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
You've been having famous people. You can do a lot better than me, bro.
No, I can't.
You had Mr. Methane, all right?
Mr. Methane.
Mr. Methane, I apologize. The farter.
Yes.
Did he fart in here?
It was on the phone.
Oh, did he fart into the phone?
He phoned it in.
No, I'm serious. Did he fart into the phone?
No, I wouldn't allow that. I actually interviewed him as though he were a musician, and we talked about the instrument and how he preps, and I found out, don't do that. There wasn't one of those. There wasn't. Stop, please, don't. And it turns out, is that a queef?
No, it was a fart, but it was like one of those, I just had some red cabbage type farts, but like I also ate other food, so it's like kind of stuck in there.
All right, so.
It's like a little release of
air. And it's about to get wet, like.
And I found out that Mr. Methane
was related to Brian Kiley. Oh no!
And his father liberated Mr. Methane from Auschwitz. He was gassing the Jews, Mr. Methane. So, a lot of people don't know this. Mr. Methane misrepresents himself. It turns out, this is, if you listen to my interview, Brian,
not going
to
happen.
No, I think I skipped that one.
It turns out he breathes through his down under.
You mean his bunghole?
His bunghole.
That's impossible.
That he can.
I can understand where you could have muscle control where you could like open it up.
Right,
but he inhales through his diaphragm.
That's unlikely.
I'm telling you the truth. And he said he discovered from his sister. He was doing yoga with his sister, and he realized he could breathe in
by creating a vacuum of sorts.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay, so, but he doesn't like breathe like it.
No, but he can. Okay.
It's not going all the way up to his lungs.
Yeah.
He's quote unquote breathing. Yeah.
Okay. Right. He's breathing in.
I know how anatomy
works. And so technically, it's not methane. It would be nitrogen and oxygen.
It would just be air.
It would be air. Mm-hmm. So he misrepresents himself.
Mm.
It's not methane.
Mm.
Although, aren't there not technically trace elements of methane
when I'm in
all
room,
the air we breathe?
Especially when I'm in a room.
Well, don't I know it, brother.
Now, let me ask you a question.
Yes.
I don't think we need this National Enquirer gimmick.
I was going to read you some
I've
items.
Never been on your show when one of these bits worked. But go ahead.
What bit?
Flipping through a National Enquirer so he can bait us with nonsensical bullshit. Let's talk about like chefing and restauranting and shit like we were talking about before because that was fun.
Okay, we had Jeremiah Tower on the show.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You guys know food. I don't know food. Your dad was a chef?
Yes.
Is a chef.
Well, he's retired now, but Yeah, he was a culinary instructor my whole life.
From Germany,
yeah.
So he really knew his way around the ovens.
Thank you. Thank you know, the difference between a pizza and a Jew, right? pizza doesn't scream when you put it in the oven.
You do. It does.
I made Jackie the joke man very angry by telling him that joke.
A pizza does scream if you put it in an oven if the topping is a live baby. So that joke is not only anti-Semitic,
it's also Baroque in its construction, in its desperation to top
that joke
Mr. McEneaney.
That joke, David, was dumb and dumpster.
Yeah, that one needs to go into the toilet at prom, that one.
So go ahead.
The New Jersey dumpster.
So you grew up around food.
I did. I grew up around chefs. One of my favorite things was when we would have a day off of school, if it was, you know, one of those.
Do they have snow days in Minnesota?
Oh, yeah.
I thought they would have no snow days in Minnesota, where they canceled school because there was no snow.
But, yeah, I would go with my dad to his work sometimes, and I still have, like, really warm and fuzzy memories of, like, giant industrial Hobart mixer and, like, when they would do butchery days, when they would butcher a side of beef.
You mean
like,
the way David
through a bandsaw.
The way David butchered
just
Brian Kiley's story?
Joke? Yeah. And the Brian Kiley story.
I used every part of that joke and that story.
Yes. But it's so more ahead. Like, it, yeah. The effect was more like Scrapple, not like high-end offal right. Repurposing at some hip Brooklyn boite.
You know how when you're poor and you eat supermarket brand hot dogs?
Uh-huh.
That was David using every part of Brian Kiley's story.
Right.
Hey, fuck like, Brian Kiley, man. That story sucks. That guy has Emmys and
hey,
fucking writers. Now, hang on for 1 second. Brian Kiley is one of the most respected comedy writers in the business. Emmys, Writers Guild Awards. He's been on Letterman.
He's my parents' favorite comedian.
We get it.
His fucking story sucked. He killed the show. Fuck it, Brian
Do you
Kiley.
Have as much reach as like Rwandan radio did in the 90s?
Yes.
Asking for a friend.
You know what? Yes. In that, when people hear the show, they cut
they
their
turn
own...
turn violently murderous?
They cut their own heads off.
With a machete? I regret to inform you that I will be killed and will kill my own family tomorrow.
So go ahead.
So that was a deep cut Philip Gravich joke in case anybody
deep,
was
I didn't get it. You know what? I'll cop to the fact I didn't understand that. But you know what?
That was a deep cut in Rwanda,
you know, Colleen,
too.
Yeah.
Colleen, I trusted you.
Thank you.
I trust you that. That was funny.
It was.
So go ahead. Your father used to
You know,
butcher.
Unlike David, I think you're actually a lot of fun in a room.
Thank you.
I know David doesn't really like think.
Yeah, David thinks that I'm a stern taskmaster.
Yeah, like a
No, I don't.
Well, then, can a bitch tell us that? Can a bitch get a sip of coffee before she gets kicked in the vag every time she opens her goddamn mouth?
Problem with Colleen in a writer's room is every time she leaves and closes the door, people start looking for spigots for ass.
So your father used to take...
Because they're all Jews in the
Your
room.
Father used to take... On butcher day, he would cut up Tutsis or Hutus?
Now this is getting too mixed up.
Okay, so all right, so you're
now this is just like a it's like a dish with too many flavors. Yes. Everything is getting muddled.
Okay, so you would have, there would be a snow day, so
yeah.
your father would take you to work.
Yep.
And he taught cooking. He was at the Culinary Institute in Minnesota.
It was called St. Paul Technical Vocational School, but it was one of the only like programs in the Twin Cities where you could learn how to become a professional chef.
Right.
But he cut his teeth as a chef in
he should
luxury. This joke is not worth it. I can tell already.
Cut his teeth as a chef.
You're literally just taking up space with like annoying high pitched noises.
You know what it is? David's afraid people will forget this is his podcast.
Yeah.
No, I wish
they'll be like, wow, this Colleen podcast turned very interesting. Oh, it's David.
Okay. All right, so your father cut his teeth as a chef.
Right.
In, like...
After he
fancy,
pulled the teeth of the Jews
right,
in Germany.
Exactly.
And you'll notice I didn't make a joke about cutting the teeth.
Well, just I applaud your restraint, David.
Let's just say he has a collection of
teeth. Can a bitch finish a story? I'll ask once again.
He has a jar full of gold teeth. That's all we're going to say.
All right. So your father was teaching, and he would take...
don't even try to catch up, because your mind is whirring, just looking for any word like to come up with the next...
No, go ahead.
Not like a whirling dervish.
I was thinking of a blender.
No.
Hey, Alex, can we cut David's mic?
You look so smug right now. It's disgusting.
What? I want to hear the story.
Here's you.
Father, daughter.
Anyway, grew up in Germany, and then he left home when he was 14, like you do if you are on the...
Did he meet Brian Kiley's father on the way out?
No, I think only Russian soldiers ever went through their village and tried to rape my oma. That's a true story. So when he left, he went to Germany and Austria and Switzerland and worked in fancy hotels and restaurants in Switzerland. And then he worked on ships that were bringing people from Europe to America. He worked in one that went from like London to Greece to Morocco to New York. He worked
cruise
on
ships.
That one. Basically, yeah.
Okay.
And then he worked for the Sheraton Ritz Hotel chain in London. He opened one in Kingston, Jamaica.
Wow.
Where he was also...
Back when that meant something, by the way.
Yeah, in the early 60s.
Noel Coward.
Well, he was Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire's private chef when they worked on a movie down there. In Jamaica. And then he worked in the Sheraton Ritz in New York on 33rd and Park, which is there no longer. But then they asked him to open up a kitchen in Minneapolis. And he thought, oh, how interesting to be in a Navy town. He thought it was Annapolis. And he got there, and he was like, oh, no. But then he met my mom, who was a beautiful young woman, who dropped off a packet of papers at his office because she was working in catering and events planning. And they fell in love, and they got married in 68. And then 2 years later, I was born. And then he decided to be a hotel restaurant chef anymore. He decided to teach so he would have better hours.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Walleye?
Why?
Walleye.
Walleye is a wonderful lake fish. Very delicate, white, and flaky. It's kind of like maybe a halibut.
Mm-hmm.
Like a freshwater halibut is what I would say.
Whenever I play Acme Comedy.
Oh, yeah. That's a delightful club.
They serve me walleye.
Mm-hmm.
When I used to eat fish.
Do you not anymore?
I don't eat fish.
Are you vegan now or something?
Well, I don't eat fish. So your father took you to school one day.
Wait a second. Are you allergic to fish?
You just...
I don't want to talk about my dating life.
Well, now that you mention it, though.
Yeah.
Are you getting your dick hurt?
Well, the real question is, are you getting your face wet?
Yes.
Fair point.
I appreciate the specificity of that.
I don't think David gives like that. Which is too bad.
Why would I want a woman to throw cold water in my face?
I'm talking about orally pleasing a woman with your mouth.
What do you mean?
Yeah, that was a...
What do you
just
mean?
A confusing construction.
You mean telling her a joke?
See, I knew you would
I've
be
I've never known David Feldman to be so coy. He's like gathering his leg toward him, his crossed leg toward himself as though to guard his body from our onslaught of nosy questions.
Well, I mean, do you think there might be a possibility that the woman I have tied up in my basement might listen to the show?
See, that's...
I do not want to offend her.
That's a joke answer.
If she listens to this podcast, is she really going to be the kind of person who's offended by things? I'm going to say no.
Yeah, considering that we just
I just destroyed...
Maybe I'm not attracted to women who funny.
We just went through 30...
That is between you and your analyst.
Maybe I don't
But that has nothing to do with our questions,
Wow, this is very interesting.
This is very telling. This is so Freudian jackpot
interesting.
Now.
What?
Because you're stumbling on the word intimacy like a rodeo clown in a mud pit.
Dude, you're stumbling on the word intimacy like a character in a sitcom that is afraid of intimacy.
Like
an 80s sitcom be like, that might be a little too broad. Let's bring that down a little bit.
Maybe I'm not...
Okay, Yeah. Then why would she be listening to your podcast?
Yeah, seriously.
Why would you be dating someone who's listening to your podcast if you don't like somebody who thinks you're funny?
Well, to be honest, he hasn't been funny yet.
True.
So.
Fair.
She might think it's an NPR-type chat show.
Right. Like a fresh air.
Yeah.
Except this is like stale air.
Terry extremely
but it's gross.
Musty air. Right. Majorly gross.
Majorly.
But
I'm majorly gross.
But I
what do you think? Go.
So you're saying you don't do that. You
do
don't go,
what?
You don't go down on a woman.
I would not. I will not discuss. What do you mean go down? I mean make fun of them?
No, perform oral sex upon.
Wait a second. When has go down ever meant make fun? Wait,
perform oral sex on a woman. They don't have penises. I don't understand what you...
Wow.
This coy whole persona just is so ill-fitting.
Dude, Fred Astaire didn't tap dance
this fast.
It's
like David Byrne's suit in Stop Making Sense, yeah. R.I.P. Jonathan Demme, a great artist.
Oh, yes. My God. That was very sad.
Yeah.
So that's a no.
What's the question?
Does David Feldman go down on women? The answer we're left with is no.
Yeah, I mean, that's the only answer I have is a no.
We have no affirmative.
I can't answer that question.
Yes, you can. Technically, you can.
Technically, you are capable
of answering this question.
You know what we're talking about.
Don't pretend you don't know what go down on it.
You know, if I brought it up in a hilarious joking context...
Are you accusing me of being a black man? Is that what you're...
I'm accusing you of being coy.
You're saying...
And, which is the corniest thing ever.
And putting a wall between yourself and your feelings.
And the interviewers.
Yeah. This is like...
Do you think...
Like, you're asking her about her family history. You're asking her to, like, open up to you. But you refuse to do, like, return the favor.
Where is the quid pro quo?
Yeah, exactly.
Where's the quo?
That's exactly right.
Where's the quid? I don't see no pro, neither.
Oh, shit. Y'all.
Bling, 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 bling.
So, wait a minute. You're back in New York. You're going,
I missed this.
Yeah, well, you're gonna come here every Saturday.
Oh God. Right? My God, I just snotted out of my nose. I got nose juice on me.
You're
really
gonna be
cold
here
in
every
here.
Saturday, right?
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No. A bitch needs to find some work. I gotta get a job, David.
I need
a goddamn job.
Oh, I do want to call in for the Fred Stoller interview.
Okay, but you said I look smug.
You did before. Now you look worried.
But what do you mean I look smug?
I don't even remember what that was about.
Do I have a smug look?
Right now, no.
But what
before you did.
You know what? Now you look like a little bit upset.
Now you look upset and concerned.
Like we got really close to something true about you, and now you're just like frantically
backpedaling. Well, I don't think it's... The rule that I have...
You're hamster wheeling.
You are. You really are.
Don't talk about my intestines.
You're backpedaling like the Polish 500.
Hang on, let me explain the joke.
No, well, please, that'll make it funnier.
Okay. You said
so Brian Kiley's father.
I was kidding. I don't want you to explain
hamster
that.
Hamster wheeling, and I said my intestines, because there's a gerbil up there. So And because I love animals, I put a wheel in my intestines.
But it only got as close as the
You're just desperate. Your mind is overactive, and you're desperate. So you're just like firing, sparking, sputtering.
You know what it is? He's looking for anything that will turn the conversation away from the fact that
he refuses to go down on women.
Yeah, it's weird. That's like a...
Why would you say that about me?
Because
that's what we're assuming, because you're playing coy with us and not answering the question. You're being evasive.
Coy?
Sketchy.
You mean like the fish?
No, bitch.
That's a poi.
C-O-Y.
What's a koi pond?
Poi.
It's a koi pond.
You are being evasive and sketchy. You can't koi pond your way out of this.
Well, because I don't think...
But the thing, David, is like it's shown that it's easier for women to orgasm if a man goes down on her first,
yes.
and then penetrates.
But what is a... women have what?
What?
Huh? Women orgasm?
You are doing such a bad job of deflecting right now.
This is fucking terrible. It's charmingly pathetic.
Do you think
we're just gonna keep on doing this?
You're giving more answers by refusing to answer.
I have a rule that I never talk about my kids or my ex-wives.
What? Well, you talk about your divorce all the time,
but I don't go into specifics.
Nobody's talking about going down on your kids. Or are we?
I, It's an invasion.
Don't cut that out, Alex.
I got into trouble for praising one of my kids on somebody's show. I got yelled at for talking about how.
Yelled at by whom?
By one of my kids for talking about how.
Who cares if your kids yell at you? They're supposed to yell at you.
It gets tiring after a while.
Dude, just
why don't you tell them to shut the fuck up and have some respect for their father?
Yeah, tell them you're not going to pay their rent anymore. They'll get in line.
Yeah, they'll fucking.
Yeah, they'll fucking
toe
get
the
in line. Yeah, that's right.
I was never allowed to be a disciplinarian.
Allowed to be a disciplinarian?
Yeah.
No wonder your kids are so fucked up.
Your kids aren't exactly the seven little foys where you're thrusting them on the vaudeville stage. I'm glad you guys get that, by the way.
I have no idea what it means, but I like the sound
Bob
of it.
Bob Hope, the seven little foys.
That was a true story.
Yeah.
It was based on Eddie Foy. I just read his autobiography. I'm going to plug a couple books before I'm out of here.
All right.
Okay.
One is called Clowning Through Life, the autobiography of Eddie Foy, okay. A vaudeville and Broadway star.
Ooh.
Was that the son or the father?
The father.
Or the Holy Ghost?
The father. When he was a kid, he survived the Great Chicago Fire. And then his mother was like the nursemaid for Mary Todd Lincoln. And he lived in Dodge City for 6 months and was friends with Wyatt Earp. It's an amazing book.
How much of it is actually true?
You know, I would actually.
By the way, Wyatt Earp is what Mr. Methane calls his anal larynx.
You know, every time there was like Wyatt something Earp? In this. Something that Every time Wyatt there was something Earp? In this book.
Larynx.
Something time there's something in this book where I was like, that can't be true. He would then reproduce like a letter from an eminent physician, or like there was a whole thing about how he was in a theater fire, basically the theater fire in Chicago that created all our fire codes in this country because
of all the gaslight.
Yeah, because everyone just died.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's just 1,000 people died because so many exits were chained and. But he was stood on stage and like sang to like calm people down as they exited so they wouldn't stampede each other.
Jesus Christ.
But it's a and anyways, that was a great book. And the other one is Jason Zinnemann's Letterman book.
Oh,
which we were talking about earlier.
What's the guy's last name?
Zinnemann.
Zinnemann.
I'm surprised you haven't had him on your podcast.
He writes about comedy for the Times.
We'll get him. I'm just doing a little too much comedy on
He's
this
doing
show.
Like all the bigger podcasts.
What do you normally do?
Well, we've been avoiding politics. I have a little Trump fatigue.
Although I will say that Trump show is fucking funny. That president show.
I haven't seen it yet.
God, it's good.
Anthony Etamananuk.
I don't know how to pronounce his last name, but his characterization of Trump is just incredible. I'm hardly saying anything that is new or original here. It's so good that he got his own show.
Right.
And does he just play Trump throughout the whole thing? It's on Comedy Central,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
so no one's seen it, but...
The first act is, like, at the desk. He does a desk segment.
So it's like, that's my Bush.
What was that?
It's a talk show.
Yeah. It's like as though Trump has his own late-night talk show. So Act 1 is at the desk, Act 2 is a pre-tape, and then Act 3 was an interview with Keith Olbermann. And then there's a little act four.
Did Olbermann play it straight, or did he try to be funny?
He tried to, but he tried to be funny, too. Yeah. He was trying to do it both ways.
Yeah.
It's like that Brian Kiley story we heard earlier.
Yeah.
Well, anyway. I have a list here from Dick Morris. You know, remember Dick Morris?
Wasn't he a speech? No.
For Clinton.
Presidential advisor?
Clinton. Yeah, he was. Well, he's
And then he sold him out, and he wrote like a whole book about how Clintons are.
Didn't he have hookers or something? Like he had some scandal?
Yeah,
Am I thinking of Marv Albert?
No, you're right.
You're right. Dick Morris, he would lick a hooker's feet. That's what he liked to do.
And you know what? God bless.
Yeah, whatever brings her pleasure, right, David?
Right. When you go down on a woman, it makes her more likely to orgasm.
I mean, he doesn't, but if you did.
Where, are you saying that there's something on a woman's toe that makes her go off?
Well, there are many nerve endings in the toes and feet, so possibly.
Have you ever had your feet sucked, David? I had a girlfriend that liked to do that. It actually feels good.
Yeah, as have I. Only in my case, it was a boyfriend.
Right. Sucking your toes.
Yeah.
I mean, she didn't love to do it, but she started.
But that, you know what? That's an early in the relationship thing. That doesn't continue unless you're like a true foot fetishist, one would assume.
Liam, yeah, but she basically started doing it one night, and I was like, oh my God, that feels great.
Well, a lot of Liam's girlfriends suck his toes because he kicks them in the mouth.
What? Wow, that got real dark.
I don't even get that. Oh, I see. Because I abuse them physically.
Yeah.
You don't like that, Colleen?
I just wasn't expecting it to take that turn. I thought it was going to be like a collegial, sort of jovial, fun lift out. And instead it was just sort of a brutal, it was like a Westworld flavored gag.
Is that what happens in Westworld?
It's super violent.
Do they abuse fake prostitutes?
Oh, yeah. They're always getting like beat up and raped like all the time.
Jesus.
But you know what's interesting is...
Wow. And is that a comedy or is it...
No, it's a very self-serious drama.
And there are guys who want to beat up robots. That's not the same thing as beating up a real woman.
Well,
you know what the interesting thing is? So David dates a woman who doesn't want him to talk about oral sex.
Right.
But does want him to talk about kicking women in the teeth.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, because it's not true.
What's not true? You don't go down on women? That's not true?
No, I will not. I've never kicked a woman in the mouth, so I can joke about it.
Allegedly.
I can joke about things that aren't true.
You know, if he pays for it.
Do not go down on women.
And do you think...
you know, if he pays for it, technically they're not people in his eyes, so you can kick him in the
mouth. Right, like that Thailand hooker who hit him in the forehead with the ping pong
that he murdered in self-defense.
My father said to me, if you can't get it up, you go down on them.
That's not true.
I'm kidding. Let me read
you. Are you, though?
What?
It had a ring of truth to it.
I was making it. I'm a very generous lover.
In that you pay them in 20s. I mean,
that's
what
great.
An elegant, simple construction.
I was going to go, I tip 50%.
Right. Right.
But that's...
Well, that's because you're Jewish, so you only have 50% of the tip left.
Dick Morris, who was a friend of Brian Kiley's. And by the way, fuck Brian Kiley for that story. Right? It's the last time I steal a Brian Kiley.
Watch.
Stop planning for this podcast and just let it flow. Because when you let it flow, this is a great
better.
Show.
I
but
have,
when you do bits and things
bits.
That you thought of.
All right, I had something. All right. Right. How much time do we have, Alex?
Half hour.
We have what?
15.
Oh, we still have more time? Right. I'm having fun.
So here's the job.
Me too. I just fogged out for a second because I'm tired.
This is hard work.
Here's the bit that David wanted to do. This is a list in the National Enquirer, and there's going to be like, oh, this is such a great list, and let me read you some stuff, Colleen. And then you're going to be like, no, this is the National Enquirer. So from jobs to trade.
Here's the thing I'll say about the National Enquirer.
It's true.
A stopped clock is right twice a day. No, don't give it away. Like, let him do his bit.
I'm deconstructing your bit, which is a lot funnier.
I don't want to be
Wait, let me just see that for a second.
Wait, so what? So I was going to be like, yuck, the National Enquirer.
Right.
I give the National Enquirer props. They broke the Gary Hart story.
And the Pizzagate story.
And the Pizzagate story.
They broke Pizzagate wasn't true, though.
Oh, it wasn't?
Allegedly.
No. Well, then I better stop posting about it on Reddit. So it's like Dick Morris wrote a column called From Jobs to Trade, Trump's Getting It Done. And then it's
Where
like
was the column?
In the National Enquirer.
Oh, it was for the Enquirer.
It was for the
and
Enquirer.
And they're for Trump. And they're for Trump.
Yes, they've been for Trump since the beginning. So
because they're mobbed up.
Are they?
Mm-hmm.
So now,
owned by the mafia?
Mm-hmm.
Can we sidebar for one second?
Of course.
What is going on with the mafia right now? Like, is that the only thing that it's got left?
No, it's got the waterfront still.
Yeah?
I mean, the waterfronts aren't as profitable as they used to be, but, you know, there's still jobs to be had.
Okay.
You want to know what happened?
I feel like the sanitation thing is not really a thing.
You want to know what happened to the mafia?
Well, I want to see Liam's take, and then I'm going to ask you.
Okay.
So basically, like, they've been marginalized because the federal government in the 90s, especially. I mean, I'm talking about, like, the Gottis and all the people in
the
New
Gambinos,
York.
The Gambinos, the Genoveses.
Right, the ones
the
I grew
Lucchesis,
up reading about in the paper.
Right.
The Daily News was mobbed up for a long time.
Interesting.
In fact, John Gotti's widow had a 5-part column about how great he was. It's just like straight up like this is why John Gotti was the greatest human being on earth.
I figured that it was just because like technology basically eclipsed the smartness of mafia people. Like mafia people thought that they could keep on doing their own way of doing things. But then it was like, oh, guess what, bitch? We've been surveilling you for like
Well, no, I mean,
ever.
They want to know the truth. Would you like to know the truth?
So they had people in the FBI, so they learned about, you know, surveillance technology and what they could talk on and what they could safely do. But, you know, like, so basically there was a lot of heat on them, and then these federal task forces broke them up, and there's a lot of,
right,
like,
they got them on RICO.
Yeah, it's a lot of stuff like that.
Would you like to know the truth?
Yeah, sure, let's do it.
Sure.
Everything Liam said is what they want us to believe.
And what do you believe?
Well, Gotti was disliked because everybody knew his business. If you're in the mafia,
he was too much of a showboat?
Yeah. If you're in the mafia, you are not supposed to talk about it.
Omerta.
So,
which is the code of silence.
Right. And in Albanian mafia, it's called the Besa.
The Besa. Mm-hmm. I like
if
that better.
If you want to know what happened to the mafia.
And the Jewish mafia is called,
they're sitting in the Situation Room at the White House. That's what happened to the mafia. Donald Trump.
Actually, Trump.
You cannot pour cement.
Okay, now we're getting into Trump crazy town.
No, Trump is mobbed up, but I don't think they're in the Situation Room.
Roy Cohn?
Roy Cohn is dead, dude.
No. Trump has been photographed with known mafia figures.
You can't pour some.
Oh, no, I know. You can't do construction in New York without the mob, obviously. But that's like low-level mob.
And, of course, Atlantic City owning the Taj Mahal.
Right.
He was the only one in Atlantic City who wasn't working with Nicky Scarfa.
So tell me, how does dropping a bomb on ISIS benefit the mafia?
Yeah.
How does building a wall benefit the mafia?
But you know what? I feel like we're just like baiting the hook.
Right. What's it called? Mother of all bombs.
Mother of all bombs.
You know about Italian men and mothers.
So what is this list that you... I'm sorry I deconstructed
your bit.
I apologize.
We weren't talking about the mafia. The fact is that the mafia, it's not what... It's evolution. Excuse me for one second, okay?
Are we going to get to Bush and Gore and, like, the fucking war in Iraq? Because I will kill myself immediately.
When the Italians,
so Brian Kiley's father,
when the Italians came to America, they had a
spicy meatball.
They had to work with the Jews because
that's a nice donut.
They needed the Jews to do the math. They needed Meyer Lansky to do the math.
That's not true at all.
No.
Otherwise, there would be Chinese people in the mafia.
Well, there are. And what happens is...
Well, just a different mafia, though.
The Tongs.
The Italian mafia through evolution, and it's even spoken about in
Godfather
3.
I'm so glad you're here, Colleen, because sometimes I'm on the show with another guest that just lets it slide. I don't want to fight this
Where did
alone.
Michael Corleone go to college?
I don't know, because you know
Dartmouth.
What? I don't fucking care about the Godfather bullshit.
That was a fictional
character.
No, the point Puzo was making
is that he wasn't smart enough to get into Princeton, Yale, or Harvard.
Bling, bling, bling. Morning with Colleen and David.
Look at my smug. Is this a smug look?
No, it just looks like you're adjusting your beanie in an uncomfortable way.
I'm going to look
Why are you wearing a beanie?
I've been in the woods for a couple of days.
But it's like literally 82 degrees outside right now.
I am going to get back to grooming tomorrow.
Is something going on with your hair transplants?
No, I'm not groomed.
I'm going bald. I'm just fucking letting it go.
All right, so
look at me. I got like 2 inches of gray roots here. Look at this.
Gray Roots.
Not good.
That was the sequel to...
it's all the characters from Roots, but they're all like 80 to 100 years old.
No, they're all aliens.
What's my name? Kunta Kinte. No, I can't remember. What's my name? Because he's got Alzheimer's.
Right.
So this list, Gray Roots. So Dick Morris put a list together. And
no,
we're
the mafia.
Read it together.
What happens is the mafia children get smart. They get educated.
Right, your Hunter Sopranos, your Meadow Sopranos.
All your fictional characters.
And then they go off to college, but they're still criminals.
Right.
But now they're working in the Justice Department, or they're working in the FBI, and
they're working in
corporate America.
Actually, they're thugs, and they do the same thing their fathers did.
They're thugs. They're corporate thugs. And you know what? Corporate thugs are much more dangerous than Lucky Luciano. Lucky Luciano, they only killed their own.
But here's another
corporate thugs kill all of us.
You know what?
Okay, Huffington
Post. I gotta. You know, Colleen, I gotta say, this time it took 75 minutes for David to get to corporate America,
right.
And the conspiracy.
And I applaud you for your restraint. I'll say that. I applaud you for your restraint.
About cutting
boy,
his teeth?
If only St. Bernie
your
had
dad
been elected.
Cut his teeth? That was restraint for me not to do a joke about your father cutting his teeth.
Oh, we're getting real now. We're getting real.
Do you know
now.
How much respect I have for you to hold back?
You actually did make a joke, though.
No, I said that there's an area for a joke. But
yeah, but that's a passive aggressive way to like. Make
also, you
joke.
You couldn't think of a good joke, but you claim that so right. that you could come back
you
later. Claim,
you like put like right. a post-it on yeah. it to come back to later, which is now.
Right. You put a pin in that map so that you could be like, okay, that's my territory.
I'm not.
That's my territory. I sell the jukeboxes to the boss.
I break a day, Tom's. I had a cutting a fart joke, by the way. Off the cutting of the teeth.
For you people at home.
You're an 8-year old skill.
I had people could at home could see the look of pain on Colleen's face.
I had a cutting the cheese joke and a cutting a fart joke when you said your father cut his teeth at the.
Do you still miss me, David?
Why are you bragging about this?
Well,
you
I'm
think
saying
I'm going to respect you?
I showed you restraint. I didn't do a
right.
cutting cheek. Right. He cut his teeth.
All right, but you're playing it both ways by saying the joke. And trying to get credit for not saying
I want
it.
Credit for not doing a cutting a cheese joke when you were doing a joke about cutting.
This is some just the tip bullshit.
$3 billion in fines for illegal imports.
Don't really? Do my bit.
Look at what a childish man you are, yanking the Inquirer out of Liam McEneaney's hands.
Of course I go down on
me.
Women.
We got him! We got him! Yay! Yay! High five. High five. All right, high five for you too. Yay! That was a really weak one. You got to redo it. Oh, yeah. No. Look, you got to look at the hand. There you go. Okay, now we just did solid high fives.
All right, there we go.
All right, now I feel completeness.
All right. What are you,
wait,
what
are
you,
we done now?
What
why
you,
is there silence?
What do you think I am?
I don't know what you are.
I was sitting here when Robert Smigel was on the show.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he was sitting where you are, Colleen. And David had a whole bit planned for that. And then Robert, while eating a lox on a bagel, sat there and just kind of quietly deconstructed what was so about. Like, what was the bit? Like, you were going to act like you didn't know who he was or something like that?
Ugh.
And then he just kind of deconstructed what was supposed to be funny about bagel. That.
It was pretty while funny.
It was very funny.
Yeah. That seems to be the deconstruction chair. You're in the deconstruction chair.
Yeah, you're in like the comic genius with yeah. no
it's
patience.
It's like the catbird seat of yeah. comedy.
The bit was that Robert Smigel came in. It was a year ago, and I brought in all these young comedy writers, and I set this up where I said,
and it made for a great show because they were all afraid to talk to Robert Smigel.
I'm sure they were feeling completely like constricted and like fearful of fucking up.
The bit
it's like I was the only one who felt comfortable talking to him because I'd met him before.
The bit was that I was putting myself on the same level as Robert. So I was saying we were talking to young comedy writers. I'm sure they have a lot of questions for me and Robert. You know, I have this podcast, so I'll answer your questions.
But what you were doing was like a weird inside baseball thing where like they can't really tell the difference because they're like
no,
two
I told
respected
them before.
Comics.
Right. I told them there were five comedy writers here. And before the bit started, before Robert walked into the room.
Right.
I said, just ask Robert questions, obviously, and I'll keep saying, does anybody have any questions for me?
Oh, okay.
Right, and then right before the show, David panicked and told Robert everything.
No, because they wouldn't do it. They wouldn't do the bit.
So Robert's sitting there like, yeah, so what we're doing right now is... So they're asking questions, and I'm
Wait,
acting like I
are we suddenly doing like a New York Magazine recap of this very podcast?
Bill,
while on the podcast,
we're
this
doing,
is so meta
we're
in
doing,
a horrid way.
Welcome to Talking Feldman, the after show for the podcast.
How is this not hosted by Chris Hardwick?
We should do an after show. This feels like this was an after show. This was like Colleen is back and Liam's back. Before we wrap it up.
Do you still miss me? Or I
do, of course. Okay, this was the most fun I've had.
I don't believe that.
Since you don't think I had a good time?
No, I believe you had a good time, but I feel like you've had a really good time lately with lots of delightful guests.
I think this is the most fun
it's not
he's
a
had.
Competition.
The most fun he's had since the last time he spent 90 seconds going down on a woman before demanding a blowjob.
It's like, oh, God, I hope that was good for you. Let's do this. Is this going to happen now?
Let's do this thing.
Dude, my friend was just telling me that his friend, like, hung out with Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch back in the day.
Yes.
She's, like, an attractive young woman.
Uh-huh.
They went to some, like, room where there was a mattress, and she was sitting next to Marky Mark.
Some room with a mattress.
It sounded awful.
Oh, God bless.
And so Marky Mark turned to her and said, so this is going to happen now? And then she went down on him.
Wow, interesting.
And she told you that.
On the mattress?
She told my friend that. Yeah, on the mattress.
Wow.
And why would a woman do that?
Because he was ripped, first of all. He was a Calvin Klein model, so he's a very attractive
man. I suppose it's, you know, a decent cocktail party anecdote for later on.
I'll say cocktail.
I don't get it.
That's not
that's
what
all
I
right.
heard. Yeah, girl.
Why would a woman do that?
You tell me, David.
I know why a guy would go down on Marky Mark. That I understand.
Colin, you have to ask Colleen why a lady would do that.
What did I say?
I, sir, am no lady. You know what? This is boring. I don't want to speak for all women.
All right.
Colin, can you do me a favor and just check this list in the National Enquirer for a minute?
All right. Before we go.
No, because he's going to snatch it out of my hands like a vulture.
Snatch.
Speaking of
snatch, David Feldman and his dating life.
Is that a haircut? Is,
yeah, that's
your throat?
A pube in his throat.
Like, oh, God, how long? My jaw is so tired. It's been 15 seconds, David.
You're only at my navel.
Yeah. Oh, my knees are numb. Oh, David, it's been like...
It's all that gardening you were doing before.
Yeah.
We're just reading.
Yeah.
We're sitting in chairs reading.
David looks up after 90 seconds. She's on the phone with her friend.
I put a New York Times crossword puzzle on her navel and...
Again, I'm just laughing at the look on Colleen's face.
I know. The funny, that's the sad thing about this show, is nobody can see Colleen.
Just how dismay. Pissed,
the dismay. We should do a game show where I
finished the motherfucking crossword today in 21:21.
You are so
bullshit.
Smart.
No.
Saturday? Do you time yourself?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I time myself every Saturday.
That's crazy.
But that's not my record, though.
What's your record?
My record, which admittedly is an outlier,
mm-hmm.
is 9 minutes and 36 seconds.
I'll say it's a liar.
You're so smart.
But that was a mega easy one. Even Rex Parker, who does the Rexword blog about the New York Times crossword puzzle, said it was an easy.
What's the record?
All-time record?
Mm-hmm.
I think some of the like super champion people can do it in like under a minute.
What?
Yeah.
You're so
but
smart.
They do it online. They type it.
Oh, then,
I do
yeah.
it in pen.
Yeah, no, you got it. Oh, you do it in pen.
Mm-hmm.
No pencil.
No.
When you're a smart... Because, I'm going to ask you a question. Because all kidding aside, because I asked Jeremiah Tower this question.
Mm-hmm.
You can spot somebody who has taste. He says he knows who has taste and who doesn't.
Thank you.
Do you
okay.
And you're really bright. Do you know who's smart and who isn't? Can you...
No.
But you
Generally,
know that you're
no.
smart.
I think I'm reasonably smart. I wish I had had a better education than I did. And I had a pretty good one. But I wish I had had
You're
a
so smart. So how many books do you read a week?
Not sometimes none. Sometimes...
Are you able to read even when you're angry, pissed off, or depressed?
No. No. If I am emotionally preoccupied, I have a really hard time doing anything.
Do you veg in front of the TV?
No, I actively watch TV.
And what do you watch shit? Or only good stuff?
The only kind of like actively garbagey show I like is those competitions like American Ninja Warrior and things like that where or like Wipeout.
Do you watch sports?
No.
Do you follow sports?
Sometimes I'll watch like rodeos, like bull riding and stuff like that, but I really don't.
That's interesting.
Do you pay attention
sports?
To things because everybody else is paying attention to them or do you pay attention only to things you're interested in?
If I'm like, "Oh, why is everyone... Why, oh, I hadn't planned... Like, I felt that way about Big Little Lies. Everyone was talking about it, and I was like, I thought it looked bad, but maybe it's interesting. And I watched it, and I'm actually glad I did.
So you pay attention to the cultural waves.
I do.
And I you're do. Influenced by what's around you.
Define influenced.
In other words, you will say what you just said. People are interested in this, so I should give it a shot.
If everyone is, like, down on a thing, I won't watch it. If it's wildly half yes, half no, I will watch it because I like things that are not controversial, but now, that
David,
people have wildly
different
opinions.
Will you watch a show?
David, do you need to clarify what down on a thing is?
Will you watch a show knowing that you're only going to watch one episode of it, even though you're going to love it? Do you feel bad that you catch one episode of something that's important, but you know you don't have the time to finish it?
I always have time. I make time for programs. I love my programs.
And what are your programs?
Well, The Americans right now, obviously. RuPaul's Drag Race, which admittedly is a bit of a lighter watch. I like MasterChef Junior. I don't really like regular MasterChef anymore, but I like the MasterChef Junior because I like the kids.
I saw Irregular MasterChef, where they cook food that isn't...
Irregular is clothing, not food.
No, I was going to make a constipation joke.
Oh,
Can I ask you...
I want to do a
Are
more...
you recruiting her for Scientology?
Am I being recruited for ISIS? Yeah, I don't even know what's happening now.
You know what I think it is? It's like David's learning how to be friends with women, but he's not entirely sure how to approach this conversation. He's trying to like figure out your level so that he can like forge a real friendship.
No, I'm attracted to very... I'm not. You're married, and I'm not attracted to
you. Oh, boy, here we go.
Well, the feeling is mutual.
Thank you. In fact, you disgust me.
Mega disgust me.
I mean, you're repulsive. No, but I do...
Literally, I'm projectile vomiting right now.
I find very intelligent women intimidating. And
yes, you've made that abundantly clear.
And I like to alpha dog them and make them feel stupid.
That's right, by obsessively going over your old weird jokes.
No, I think smart women.
Zing, ding, 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 ba, ba, ba.
No, I'm fascinated by smart women.
Here's three shows I really enjoyed lately that I think you might enjoy too. Number one, Occupied. It's on Netflix. It's a Norwegian show that is taking place in the very near future. It's from an idea by Joe Nesbo, that Scandinavian crime
I know his sister.
Guy.
Yeah, yeah. I know his sister doesn't like men.
Stop it. You know what? Don't even...
It was just sad is what that was. It was just sad.
Stop it.
It wasn't even charming.
Nope.
His name is Nesbo. He has a sister.
Please, you know what?
You know what women
like is being interrupted with like unworthy comments, like over and over and over again.
Explain to you.
Do your own fucking podcast. Like, you can do your own separate podcast where you just say your own jokes out loud to your own self.
No, you have to book like young women. You can interrupt and talk
right?
over.
Yeah.
You'll notice the restraint that I didn't say Joe Lesbo. I think I get
you
a
don't get any credit for that.
But I didn't say it.
You implied it.
Yeah.
No, actually, you did say it, but in the context of like, I would never make this joke.
It was apparent.
Yeah, this shitty playing it both ways thing is not cute on you. Nope. Yeah, it's not a good look.
It doesn't work because it doesn't work for us because we recognize it.
All right. Occupado like on Telemundo.
Occupied.
Occupado on Telemundo.
It's actually called Okupert. Okkupert.
Is that Norwegian for occupado?
Yep. So it takes place in the very near future, and the conceit of the show is that Norway has decided to stop producing all oil and gas in order to commit completely to clean energy. So
there are no Jews in Norway, so it's a lot easier to stop producing gas.
Right, there's no pickled herring.
David's so mad right now.
No, I don't know. I don't know whether or not you're saying because if they're Jews, you have to get Zyklon B.
No, I thought it was because
they're gassy people.
Yeah, that's what I thought it was.
Yeah, Jews are gassy people.
Yeah,
but then I was like, but there is a lot of pickled fish to be eaten in Norway.
That's true.
Either way, whether you're Goyish or Jewish,
that is true. That is true.
The stereotype about Jews being gassy, it was the Nuremberg defense.
I'll let that. Pity silence.
They were gassing themselves.
So what's,
look at them.
So anyway, the
I am in the
EU,
glass booth, so I don't smell them.
So the EU and Norway, or I mean, the EU and Russia collude to basically force Norway to keep producing the oil and gas, and then slowly and incrementally, Russia like takes over Norway.
Mm-hmm.
And there's only like 10 episodes or 12 episodes in the first season, which is all that there is on Netflix right now. But it is so possible. This shit is a crazy series. It's so good.
We feed them the Chinese food and we let them gas each other.
The Chinese food.
Yeah, it makes you gassy.
It's
I thought he was
spicy.
Doing a, I thought he was doing a Norwegian accent.
I did it first, and then I was like, "Oh no!"
He's
no, it was no. A you know what? German accent.
You know what? You guys are not turning this around on me. I'm not.
No. You weren't in the moment.
Well, I was going to bring back this joke.
Yeah, you can't do that.
And
this
really
show.
Annoy her.
You can't do this.
See, I was going to give you a lifeline.
At first, I thought you were being my dad.
No.
And I didn't understand what was happening.
Do you
so
love
that
your
was,
dad?
I do.
Good.
He's a good dad.
Good.
He was a good dad. He still is a good dad.
Good.
You His see, name is Eberhard.
You've got interesting names in your life.
Mm-hmm.
You
and
still
your husband's
him?
Name is?
Gardner Comfort. Gardner Bell Comfort is his full name.
That's
and
the,
his actual name.
That is such a great name.
It's a fantastic matinee idol name.
And
of
you're
Hollywood.
So, you know.
And he's a super nice dude.
You know what?
Yeah.
We started talking about World War II and the Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
And for my Japanese fans listening in Japan, we actually have a comfort woman here who is not Korean.
Don't ever call me that again. I mean, I did have sex with thousands of Japanese soldiers against my will, but I call it... I call it...
All right, that's it. You're coming back here every Saturday.
I call
you're
it...
Coming,
I call it the Rising Sun Ladies Auxiliary Service.
See? Now, you're coming back every Saturday.
You know why it's called the Rising Sun?
Liam, do you know of any jobs I can do that work on Saturday?
I am calling.
You know why they're called the Rising Sun, by the way? Because those guys, much like David, never go down.
I am voting for the strike, because if there's a strike, that means Colleen
will be unemployed.
And she'll be here every week.
Are you guilt?
I am.
Okay.
As of 2010.
Congratulations.
Liam?
I will be free to sit in L.A. and crank out more spec scripts.
When are you coming back to New York?
I will probably be back for my birthday, which is August 1st. So that's probably I'm going to come back for a week and see some friends and, you know, like...
Why don't you come back here?
I got to work, you know, and there's...
We got to wrap it up.
There's no work for me in New York. That's... Well, you were so busy asking Colleen about TV shows.
All right.
Listen... I'm just saying, watch Occupied. It's totally worth it.
Okay. How do people reach you, Liam?
Go to heyitsliam.com. You can go on Spotify and listen to my albums, Working Class Fancy, Comedian. There's Tell Your Friends the Concert Film. I've done a lot of shit. And you know what else? 2016, GQ Spain called me one of the 100 funniest comedians of all time.
Nice.
GQ Spain.
GQ Spain.
España?
I get no love in America, but apparently in Europe, people dig my shit.
You're muy grande in Madrid.
I'm muy grande everywhere if I don't start working out.
And...
LA gentlemen!
Bling, 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 bling!
Coming up next, new Aria Grande!
Colleen?
Yes?
How do people reach you?
Tentatively at best.
How do people get in touch?
I have her phone number, so if anyone needs it, just email me.
First of all, I want to give a big shout out to all the basement masturbators. I didn't even reference them once this whole time.
Oh, the basement.
What's up, BMs? How you doing?
I don't get that.
Oh, that's what David's audience is comprised entirely of. Basement masturbators.
She said, I'm sorry to offend your listeners, all those basement masturbators, and that took off.
And then one man felt compelled to tell me that he lived in California and didn't have a basement, so I was like, okay, front yard masturbator.
Did he email you?
Yeah, he tweeted at me.
Yeah. A lot of...
Which you can also do, other basement masturbators.
Why don't we do...
At C. Werthmann.
And you can,
I'm going to say my Twitter handle.
You can tweet at me at Hey, It's Liam.
Okay, and how do...
I'm at C. Werthmann. That's C-W-E-R-T-H. M as in Mary, A, double N like in Nancy.
Can we get a...
That's some good branding.
We got to wrap it up. Can we get a wild line, and we'll start the podcast with this. Hello, hello. I'm Colleen Werthmann. Hello, basement masturbators. This is Colleen.
This is another great David Feldman bit for his podcast.
This is Colleen. Hello, basement masturbators. This is Colleen.
I'm not going to do exactly what you tell
me. Okay.
What's up, basement masturbators? I'm Colleen Werthmann. You're listening to the David Feldman Show.
Yo, yo, yo. You listen to the hottest show on podcast. I'm Liam McEneaney. It's David Feldman Show right now.
Thank you. Joining us.
Oh, man.
You're on. We're rolling. Eddie Pepitone, my muse, my beloved Eddie. My beloved Eddie, how are you, sir?
Oh, hi, David. How are you, buddy? You're at the... We miss you over here on the West Coast.
Thank you.
We need some people who read over here. There's not many readers, as you know, on the West Coast.
Mm-hmm. And most of them are writing for television. So Eddie,
what's going on with the writer's strike, by the way? Do we want to talk about that at all?
I will talk about the writer's strike. Anything to shut Hollywood down is a good thing. Anything that just stops TV is a good thing.
Yeah, it probably is, right?
Well, the country is completely effed, Eddie Pepitone. I know that you voted for Trump. I know you have this act where you're the disenchanted.
Well, I wanted to shake things up. How about the people who say that? Like, I voted for Trump just to shake things up. Oh, you mean to open up public lands for exploration? I heard Mark Maron, I'm a regular at the Comedy Store now, not to brag, but I heard Maron say on stage, so it looks like hunting in zoos will be legal soon.
So tell me what you've been up to. Have you been traveling? Well, we'll talk about politics in a second. It's been a while. Last time you did the show, you were calling as a pretend Trump supporter. So tell me some good news. Yeah. Let's start with some good news. Tell me good news.
Good news.
I want five good things. Five good things.
Oh, you know, for me, that's hard.
No,
my wife's car started up right away today, and we were afraid it wouldn't. That's good. Number one.
Good.
Basil and Charlotte are very well. They run after squirrels. It's just a beautiful thing. We have a nice green big park here that also serves as a homeless encampment, but the park itself... You know, you can't look. Any public space in the United States now is teeming with homeless people because of, the deindustrialized nightmare that the United States has become because corporations are allowed. By the way, this is funny that this is on my list of good things. I can't help but getting into it. But
you're absolutely right. There was an article by an MIT professor. He has a new book out.
Noam Chomsky?
I want to get him on the show. He has a new book out. 80% of Americans are in debt and are suffering from job insecurity. He said that fits the model for a third world nation. When 80% of a population are racking up debt and are experiencing job insecurity and fear, it's the model for a third world nation. So,
We know that that's the case, that it is true. It really is very starkly, it's haves and have nots. And it's gotten scarier, which I didn't think was possible with this administration, and just the absolute disregard for people in debt and, you know, on the edge and all that stuff. It's just what? How about you? Are you scared? I mean, the other three things that are going well for me is that I'm a paid regular at the Comedy Store, and I've been doing a ton of sets. And I was always scared to do the Comedy Store. I was always kind of intimidated by
it. It's Adam now. He's
Adam. You're right. Adam Egget is just a doll. Mm-hmm. And he's changed the vibe there. It's a real happening place. So every night I've been performing in front of huge crowds. Huge. And really growing as a stand-up.
That's great.
And then I've been working three times a week with a personal trainer. But the funny thing about that is that my cholesterol, it's good but not great. And he tells me, I've been working three times a week with a personal trainer for almost a year, and I just had a physical for the first time in about this, you know, a year or whatever. And he said, you have to diet and exercise. So I don't know what the hell I'm doing wrong with that.
The Comedy Store, that's great news. I did the Comedy Store. Mm-hmm. I could not pass Mitzi. She wouldn't pass me.
She wouldn't pass me either.
Yeah, so I just, is she there? Who was that? And what happened to me, anyway, I don't want to talk about me. Anyway, but I was back there, and Adam is like the great, you know, he's taking over. Go look at Norm MacDonald's YouTube television show. Adam is his sidekick on it. They don't make them anymore.
I know.
And he would read jokes to Norm. There's one episode with Super Dave that might be one of the funniest things I've ever seen in my life. Adam reading these horrible jokes to Super Dave, and Super Dave is just yelling. So that's great news. That's great news about the Comedy Store.
Yes, it's good for me. Yeah, yeah. I've been traveling a little. I'm going to Atlanta in June to film. I'm a regular on this Adult Swim show called Your Pretty Face is Going to Hell.
With Craig Rowan.
We're filming a new season. Yes, your buddy Craig Rowan. He's a big part of that show.
Mm-hmm.
Henry Zabrowski, Matt Servito, who was a regular on The Sopranos as a DA agent who used to chase Tony. Real funny guy, really nice guy. Anyway, so I'm going to Atlanta. And last time I was in Atlanta, from my hotel balcony, there was a huge protest trying to get onto Interstate. I think it's Interstate 80 out there. And right from my balcony, I saw this standoff between protesters and the cops. It was the time last summer when it was all about the cops shooting people and stuff like that. I was in the middle of that in Atlanta from my balcony.
That's better than Spankavision. Who needs to rent porn when you can watch protesters and cops in Atlanta of all places?
Right.
Let's discuss what's going on in the world, because in the past, you've come on the show and complained about how bad things are. And I've always agreed with you, but I kept it to myself. And I would say, but Eddie, we need to be positive. We need to be upbeat. We can't let our listeners wallow in self-pity. So what did we do? We got to three good things in your life. Your wife's car turned over. You have two dogs who chase squirrels. And you're performing at the Comedy Store. Okay, maybe, but we'll get to five. I say unto you, Eddie, it's so bad out there in this country, in America. It is so bad. It is so bad.
Why are you saying that? Is this just personal, you know, personal experience, or are you reading and watching particular news reports?
I am telling people things are bad, and they're saying to me, you're letting your demons get a hold of you. You have inner... I don't have inner demons. It sucks. How can life be good when 80% of us are terrified? When you have this, you know, president and people go, but he doesn't affect... He does. The whole mood of the country is shaped by what's happening in Washington, D.C. You can turn off the news and not pay attention. But it filters down because it's filtering up. Trump is there because it filtered up. It's not filtering down. We ended up with Trump because the disease filtered up and put him into office. And everybody is miserable. Well, and it's a lie. Trump. The whole country is a lie. Everybody's life in America is a lie.
Well, you know who my guru is. It's Chris Hedges. And he puts it, the way he puts the lie is that people retreat. They retreat into fantasy when their reality is too difficult to deal with. And I think that is the lie you're talking about. People are pretending that things are fine. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I'm really way too into my dogs chasing squirrels, for instance.
and you love squirrels. Didn't you, like, almost beat a guy up because he was throwing rocks at squirrels?
Well, I never... Yeah, I mean, I am a squirrel protector, which is similar to a water protector, except it's squirrels and not water. And there's a few of us in the park who protect squirrels.
Now, where are you now?
I'm in North Hollywood.
No, I'm saying, where are you? I hear, like, a plate, or what do I hear in the background?
Wow, that's one of your superpowers, is hearing... a spoon hit a porcelain bowl. My wife's eating cereal across from me.
Oh, I see. All right, let's go over some
very good, very good, very good hearing.
Let's go over.
Oh, yeah, everything is bad. Trump is a manifestation. By the way, Trump didn't come from, Trump didn't come out of the blue. Trump came as a progression. And I don't know if we've talked about this, but I don't think you completely agree with me. Trump is a progression of the corporate coup d'etat that has happened in this country. And the Democrats, and I think me and you have had a little bit of disagreement on this, the Democrats, the corporate Democrats, I call them, and Hedges call them, you know, they sold us out. The Democratic Party sold us out. And since the Democratic Party stopped representing the working man and woman and the middle class, you got Trump because, you know, the quote-unquote deplorables were taken in by his hucksterism because they lost faith in the Democratic Party. I don't know if you agree with me or Hedges, but that's
absolutely
what he says.
Absolutely.
They sold this out. I mean, everybody talks about how, you know, I mean, Obama was a very civil guy, but I think, as Jimmy Dore puts it, he was like a very nice, elegant, good-looking face on corporate war and corporate evil. Mm-hmm. And now we have the ugly face.
Absolutely. I do love Obama because I have to believe in right and wrong, and they give me two options, Republican and Democrat, and I go, okay, Democrats are right, Republicans are wrong, when in fact, they're both wrong.
Yeah, do you see this coming? I think this is scary to me, but I think it needs to be done. There's got to be massive unrest here soon when 80% of the population is in terror, don't you think?
No, I don't. I think that it's a subtle terror. We police ourselves. When you're terrorized, it's mostly we do it to ourselves. We blame ourselves because we pick up the newspaper and read about the wealthy, and we're obsessed with the wealthy, and we buy into the lie that they deserve to be wealthy and that they're happy because they're wealthy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
No, I don't think there's going to be massive unrest because we're a police state. Right?
well, that's not a good thing that we're a police state.
But why haven't the African Americans who, you know, the African Americans are saying to me, hey, welcome. How does it feel?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And why haven't African Americans rose up?
Because of the massive military force, right?
We live in a police state. If you're black, we live in a police state. If you're black in America, we live in a police state.
fact. That's
right.
A fact.
Right.
It is a
a fact.
It is a fact.
That is a fact.
If you're black, this is a police state for black men.
Yep.
And because it
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, and now, you know, people, African-Americans are telling you, welcome to their world, right? Because mm-hmm. it's now extended to, you know, everybody in poverty.
So there won't be a mass uprising. It'll be a whimper. It's over.
Well, how will things... It's over?
Yeah. The country's over, Eddie.
Yeah.
I kind of
agree.
When people say to you, how do you think it's going to end? It's over. Get up. Get up. You can leave now. There's a new show about to start, but it's over. Look who's in the White House. It's over.
Yeah.
Why can't, you know, the problem with America is we never admit defeat. We've never lost a war. We can't even say we lost in Iraq. We can't even say we lost in Vietnam. We lost. And guess
Afghanistan.
What? Guess what, folks? Look who's president. It's over. It's over. Accept defeat. It's over. Now what?
Right. Now what? That's what I'm asking. I say massive unrest. You say no. So what happens?
I'm creating an app for Americans to pick a new government. It's a Tinder app where you swipe left if you want to reject fascism. Swipe left. Democratic Republic. Swipe right. We have to start all over again. It's over.
And if so we need like big grassroots political stuff, huh?
Well, I'd rather hear your opinion, but I will say this. I pissed off a lot of people when I said that the end to Reconstruction was the worst thing that ever happened to this country, because the Civil War, we defeated the South. We burnt Atlanta to the ground. And we freed the blacks, and there were more black senators and congressmen representing the South than at any time in American history, especially now. But then there was this unholy deal that we made to get Rutherford B. Hayes into the White House. And the deal was, we'll give you Rutherford B. Hayes, but you have to put an end to Reconstruction. So they ended Reconstruction.
Now, Reconstruction was... explain Reconstruction to me again.
They take hair from the back of my head and they plant it on the top where the hair is missing. And then you wait a couple of months and it grows. And it's your hair. And the technology now is nobody can really tell. So that's... Reconstruction was rebuilding the South in our image, the same way we built Germany and Japan in our image. Germany and Japan were the victims of total war after World War II. We mowed them down. I'm not bragging. I'm not getting erect. Well, semi-erect. But America won. Russia won. Britain won that war. And we said to Japan, we said to Germany, say Uncle Sam, say Uncle Sam. And they said Uncle Sam, and we stopped bombing them. And they admitted defeat. It was over. Everything they stood for was wrong. Germany, everything you valued is gone. We're rebuilding you in our image. We're God. Japan, we'll let you keep Hirohito, but we're rebuilding you in our image. And we did, and they surpassed us. If they are the American dream is alive and well in Germany and Japan, because they have the values of the greatest generation.
Even in Japan, I know Germany is kind of at the forefront of the economy, right?
Well, Japan, yeah.
But Japan,
they have a social safety net, yeah.
Oh, they do.
Sure. And they're going through a quote unquote recession. We should only have the type of recession they have in Japan.
Well, I mean, you know, Europe, though, is also right. Europe is also undergoing economic and, you know, strains of fascism as well. Right. Brexit, the French election. I mean, the far right is all over Europe, isn't it, popularly?
Yeah, but are they winning?
I don't really think so.
No.
Right?
No.
But over here...
The far right...
So what's going to be over here? What's going to be over here? I don't know.
It's a whimper. It ended with a whimper, not with a bang. Mm. Anybody mm-hmm. who is looking at us from afar would say, it's over. But there's value to it being over. If we could admit it's over,
right,
then we can rebuild.
What are you saying? What are you saying is over, by the way, specifically? Democracy?
I'm in a bad mood today. Yes. I'm saying the Republic is over. Today, I feel that.
Yeah.
What triggered it?
The hair? The reconstructive hair?
I think it's like divorce. It's like a marriage.
Mm-hmm.
The person who wants the divorce knows that it's over. The person right. who doesn't want the divorce doesn't have a clue that it's over. And I think America is a 50-year-old man whose wife has decided it's over, and she has this plan to get out. She has an exit strategy, and the husband is completely oblivious to the plan and doesn't know that the marriage ended when Obama got elected. He thought things were getting better.
Yeah.
But when Obama got elected, she had a plan. Here, pay attention to this constitutional lawyer. But it was over
now,
back then.
If I'm following the metaphor right, she
yeah.
is the corporate state.
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, well.
Let's go over the news.
I don't know.
What do you think? What do you think of Kelly Ripa picking Ryan Seacrest to be the co-host? I'm being serious.
The co-host of what?
Live with Kelly. She was doing it. The sister was doing it by herself for about a year.
How do you stay up on that, by the way? How do you stay up on that?
Because it's important, Eddie. It's important. Do you think Ryan...
But I can't even do it in a... Well, I think Ryan Seacrest... Not only is he beautiful, bone structure-wise, you know, and I think me and you discussed that many times mm-hmm. late in the evening, mm-hmm. but, you know, he's charming. I'm pretty sure Ryan Seacrest chases squirrels.
mm-hmm. But feeds them.
Yeah.
He chases
yeah,
them to
no,
feed them.
No, I don't
them.
Even... I hate to tell you, that you know what you're talking about is funny and sad, which is that Americans distract themselves, and it's part of this. You know, the corporate state is there's never a better time. Like everybody's talking about the whole country. There's an eco genocide happening. There's everybody in debt. And people are talking about the great production values on Game of Thrones. Right?
Yeah.
The rape and pillage on Game of Thrones and the incredible, beautiful look of the show. I swear to God, people are more interested, and this is what I mean about people retreating into fantasy. Hollywood is a factory of shit.
Okay, you're distracted.
There is hardly,
I want to talk to you about the issues. Yep. What about Ellen DeGeneres and Drew Barrymore? Do you think, because as you know...
What's going on? What, you're really up on this stuff.
What are you talking about? Ellen runs a show called First Dates, and Drew Barrymore does the voiceovers.
First Dates.
Yeah, it's a great show on television, and... Portia de Rossi is jealous that Ellen is spending more time. What are you laughing at? Do you think Ellen's marriage is in trouble? Do you think she and Portia are going to break up? Is Drew Barrymore? I think she's playing Ellen the same way the other one did. What was her name? Who created her own language? I forgot her name.
Who created her own language? Was that Leakey?
Anne Hage.
Leakey or Diane Fossey?
Was it Anne
Hage? Diane Fossey. Oh, Diane Fossey and the gorillas. Oh, Anne Hage.
Remember Anne Hage?
A language. Oh, yeah. Didn't she have a nervous breakdown?
Yeah, but
that was what she...
She pretended she was a lesbian and tricked Ellen. And now Drew Barrymore is trying to break up the marriage between Ellen and Portia Del Rossi. Do you think Drew Barrymore is really a lesbian? I mean, she's been married before. Is she pulling an Anne Hage? Yes or no?
Oh, wow. This is really difficult because, you know, this is right up there with the U.S. having the largest prison population in the world.
It is. Because what you're saying, and I understand what you're saying, is that Ellen and Portia are trapped in a relationship that resembles a woman's prison.
I didn't even know. I'm really glad we spoke because I didn't know that Ellen's marriage was in trouble. But now that I do, I am going to put down this Noam Chomsky book, Who Rules the World, and go online and look at this marriage disintegrating. What is Ellen doing? Like, how is Ellen handling it? Who seems to have the upper hand? I mean, that's really kind of the crux of it. Is Ellen okay? That's always my first thought.
I don't know.
When an impending writer's strike. I heard she was so good to the writers the first time around. I hope she has a solid, you know, a solid family life going on. You don't know what's happening?
I don't know. I don't know what's going on.
Okay,
with
you brought it up.
I heard that she's been dating Ellen Page from Juno. Or that... No, I'm sorry. I think...
Juno?
No, I don't know. I made a mistake. Drew Barrymore has been dating Ellen Page from Juno, according to my sources.
I didn't know Drew... So Drew Barrymore is bi? Is that what you're saying?
I don't know. It's just very confusing.
Well, you keep throwing out information and then saying, I don't know. So what's going on? Is this fake news you're throwing at me? What are you doing?
No, I would never.
Are you trying to get me involved in these Hollywood celebrities? What do they call them? Tete-a-tete? You know, the affairs of the rich and famous. Do you remember Robin Leach, by the way?
Robin Leach? Champagne wishes and caviar dreams.
How obscene. How obscene does that seem now with the way the country, now it's like in the White House. Welcome to the White House. That's Mar-a-Lago or wherever Trump has his. Welcome to the White House. There is no more visitors log. Oh, my God. Robin Leach. Where is he now? Has he taken his life?
No, we tried to actually hire him for something, and he wanted to do it, but it was too anti-Trump, and apparently...
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah, he wanted to do it, but then he saw that it was going to be anti-Trump, and I guess he still thinks Trump can butter his bottom.
Yeah.
You see, I'm old enough. No, the listeners don't know who Robin Leach was, but he... created the show called Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. When it first came out, it was an obscenity because Reagan had just taken office, and the idea of celebrating wealth in America was so alien to us.
Now, look at it now, where it is a complete country divided into winners and losers, right? It's just winners and losers, and... you know, this whole thing about equating success with material wealth. And, you know, it's really sick. It's really sick.
And it started under Reagan. It started under Reagan.
Yeah, he started dismantling everything. The unions, the air traffic controllers, you know, he started...
And by the way, I'm a member of the Writers Guild, and I'm all for the strike.
What's going on? Yeah, what's going on with that?
Well, what's going on is I think the Writers Guild is perfect, and I love the Writers Guild. However, we're not factory workers. The people shutting down the town are the owners. The Writers Guild.
That's right.
The writers, I'm not. But the people who write television, not movies, but the people who write television, are the owners. They own the shows. So you would have, I mean, the last strike in television, you had guys like Aaron Sorkin striking against themselves.
Oh, really?
They own the shows. The writers own the shows. They were striking.
Well, how do you strike against yourself? That obviously isn't completely true. Well,
they didn't want to spring for lawyers. They're all negotiating these massive deals for themselves, and then they use the union as a cudgel. But as in any union, the only people who benefit from a strike are the top 1%. The rank and file. The rank and file are just marching out of solidarity, but the guys who run the strike are marching because they want their piece of the pie.
I say, like the big showrunners, the big creators.
Yeah, yeah.
Of TV.
Yeah. So what they do is, it's a lot like war. They'll feed me religion.
Right.
I'm fed religion and solidarity. And we're all in this together.
Right.
So I'll go, okay, D-Day, I'll storm the beach.
Yeah.
Because it's for the greater good. The guy laying back in Dover with the binoculars stands to make $1 billion.
Mm, I see, yeah.
That's
it. Boy, will the world ever change?
No. No.
It won't.
Did I depress you?
No, I was, I'm deep into that, deep into depression. I now just explored depression as Lewis and Clark once explored this great land.
What triggers a depression for you?
Well, it's hard to say, but for me, my depression takes the form of anxiety. Are you like that? Like, I don't get real, I've had some dark, I don't know about where your depression goes to, but I have had a couple of times in my life where, there's that heaviness and, you don't want to move. But mine sort of takes the form of being anxious. And so, I try to combat that with, I have a very large, I'm quilting Ellen right now. Like, I have a quilt and it's Ellen dancing, and it just says, and the bottom of it says, get up and dance and don't worry about, the 80%, the 99%. But I get kind of anxious. I'm not sure what triggers it. I think money, status. Am I doing, am I being left behind by, the world? I think a big thing in today's world is you have to feel community with people, because the times are very tough. And if you're not connected to a community, I think, that isolation can be very disturbing.
Right. Absolutely.
Do you agree?
Yeah. And I think I'm isolated and I find it depressing.
Yes, it is.
And
I'm just laughing because of the, I think I'm isolated, is a very funny sentence if you could step back from it.
Well, I can live my life under the illusion that I'm around people. Because, I'll go out and do stand-up tonight, and I'll be around lots of people tonight.
Right.
But I'm isolated.
Yeah, it's interesting that you can be isolated. Yeah, it's interesting that you can be isolated within. And I think people, you know, that's part of the strategy. I don't know if it's a conscious strategy, but that's part of kind of the technological, you know, development of the land. You know, like the technology has isolated us, I think. You know, the computers, you know, the phones, the laptops, the TVs. It kind of makes everybody a little insular. And then the world seemed to get, you know, people believe that it's a dangerous place. They don't want to leave. They don't want to, you know, explore. You know what I mean? They don't want to go in. They don't want to go into dark alleys. Yesterday, me and my wife walked to two dogs in a dark alley, and it was liberating. It was a little dangerous, but, you know, we came out to tell the tale.
Were the dogs okay? Were they scared?
Well, they're the ones who bring us there. We have a little dog, Basil, who just loves, we don't know what this is, but he loves little alleys. We think he's trying to kill us. he's so small. If you've seen Basil, he's so small and cute. Yet he's always like, bringing, you know, the little Muppet, he's always bringing us into these like godforsaken places, you know.
He's like Jimmy in Goodfellas saying to Lorraine Bracco, yeah, go in there, go, the coats are in there, just walk in there.
yes. Just but go. We've managed to escape his plot so far. I don't know. We think he's got he's just got our bank account information and is waiting for us to perish.
Do you let Jimmy from the Goodfellas movie? Do you let him lead you when you walk? Do you follow? You just let him?
Yeah, we do. We do because we see the state of affairs and we know the future is bleak. So if it ends, it ends. I mean, that is one good thing about. You know, knowing that the future is blank, is that, you know, as you, you know, you just go into more and more danger and, you know, hope that the pain will soon be ceased.
It must be interesting to let a dog, in all seriousness, let the scent, because they're following a scent,
right?
That's
right. They're following a scent, yeah.
And do Basil and Charlotte agree on the scent that must be followed?
No, that is a difficulty, and we let Basil determine the path because Charlotte is more malleable, whereas Basil, you know, once he gets his mind set on something. Well, me and my wife are actually thinking of writing, I mean, we have to get to it, but we're thinking of writing an animated show with Basil, and we call it Hunting Bin Laden's dog, because of the way Basil walks on the street is hilarious. We think it would be so funny to film him walking, and he's just hearing from a commander. He's got a little earpiece in his ear, and it's like, Basil, you must go straight ahead. Bin Laden's dog, we have it, you know, from our GPS unit and aerial photography. He's in the yard to your right, and then Basil just like will sit down under a tree. Basil, what are you doing? It's like, no, I'm just taking it right now. I want to rest. But Bin Laden's dog, and it's, you know, it's very funny. Anyway, this is how we.
What kind of dog is Basil?
He is. We had a DNA test run on him,
and he killed Nicole Simpson, and they freed OJ.
He turned out to kill Nicole Simpson with the DNA. Yes. No, he's what is he, honey? He's a lapso. Chihuahua, lapso opso, and a Norwich Terrier.
He's a lapsed apso. It's like a lapsed Catholic.
You know, that is a funny thing, by the way, when I'm working out. And my trainer has no clue that we are, you know, he's one of these guys who says all you have to do is think positively about life. And I point out that the oceans are rising, and he goes, don't. You have to think positively, and I point out that 80% of people are in terror, in debt, and he says you have to think positively. You have to see a golden ball of light, and, you know, and I then point out that we have the largest prison population in the world, and that you know, we live in a police state, and you know what is now, what has happened to the African Americans now happening to white middle class and lower white middle class people. And he says, please think positively, and let you know. So it's a weird relationship I have with the guy.
I think of it as positive. We're number one in anal rape.
Right.
We have more people behind bars. We're the leading country when it comes to anal rape. Here's the thing. I know you have to go. I know you have to go train.
Yeah.
And do you carry the escape hammer? Remember when for your birthday, when you turned 40, I bought you an emergency blanket and an escape hammer. Do you carry the escape hammer with you at all times? It'll break any type of window or glass.
Well, have you thought about that? You know, well, you don't think there's going to be unrest. You think it'll just be a general rounding up, quietly rounding up.
No, I think we've already been rounded up. I think we're our own prisoners.
You're right.
My dinner with Andre. Did you ever see My Dinner with Andre?
I did, and that's he says we're the jailers and the warden.
Yes, and I think that's pretty much
what we... I have the My Dinner with Andre action figures. Now, by the way, that isn't my joke. That was in Christopher Guest's Waiting for Guffman at the end. They did all this really funny, like, little one-off things. And My Dinner with Andre action figures were hilarious.
My Dinner with Andre ruined me because it came out, I think, like in the mid to early 80s. And I thought...
Yeah.
This is what a movie should be. Just two guys talking.
I loved it. I loved
it. Me too. I loved it. It was just a...
Like you, we both love, which, you know, the Buddhists say is not great. We both love to, like, engage our minds and, like, chew on philosophical questions. Whereas the Buddha and the religious people, the spiritual people say we have to divorce ourselves from mind and ego. Let that go.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, kind of be taken into the womb. Maybe that's what my trainer means. Just let go of all this talk about how horrible. Maybe this is how we'll wind this up today. Instead of, you know, talking about, you know, the outer reality of, you know, the country, you know, having, as you put it, we've lost already. Maybe our inner reality can be different, even if we're, you know, not doing well outer-wise. What do you think of that?
I think that's true. And I think the lesson that I'm taking away from this conversation is we are communal animals. We need to be around other living things. And I find, listening to you, that the danger of people... Mm-hmm. Being around people, this addiction to people is very isolating. That the more time I spend, you know, when I'm face down in another human being, it's taking me away from what's really important in life. So I need to do a detox, a human detox, and stop being around people because that's the real poison. More time on the phone. More time... dealing with you.
I don't know if you're getting the lesson right, but
I love you, Eddie. I miss you.
I love you too, buddy.
When are you coming to New York?
I don't know. I don't have anything booked in New York.
Hey, we did a live show. We did a live taping of the podcast last
week. Oh, you did? Who did you have on it?
We didn't do... We had Sean Donnelly, Angela Cobb, and Pat Dixon. We did it at a QED.
QED, oh, in Queens?
Yes. And we didn't do it old school, Eddie. I remember, because you were the reason I first started doing live podcasts.
Was it the live one I did in the apartment there?
No.
Alex's place?
It was kind of like that. It was just me talking to people. But if you ever come back,
right.
I miss... Mm-hmm. Those big production numbers that we used to do.
Oh yeah. I can't believe that was the genesis of your podcast with you writing and Rosenfeld, Steve Rosenfeld. I don't know where he is. Do you know where Rosenfeld is?
I don't know. And Jim Earl, those were some of the funniest things ever. And you know what? They're just sitting on the website. People can find them. They're just, you have to.
Oh, man. They were insane.
But you just have to.
They were insane.
They were so. Let's, before you go, tell me about Gary Shapiro. Yeah. Wasn't he
great? Oh. Yeah, sweetheart of a guy, very funny, and died suddenly a couple days ago. Kind of a shocking thing. What were your memories?
He was a perfect human being. He was a rabbi.
Yeah.
He was a comedian, a songwriter, a comedy writer, and a musician. There wasn't anybody on the planet who had a bad word to say about Gary Shapiro.
That's very true.
Except you and me.
Yeah, well, I have issues with everyone.
No, he was...
He's a sweetheart, right?
Yeah, yeah. All right. By the way,
we lost Don Rickles.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, I know you're a fan of him, right?
I love Don Rickles.
He lived a nice long life, though. Who me and Karen went and saw? We saw Bob Newhart in the La Miranda Theater. We had to go south on the 5 to see Bob Newhart. And I thought he was going to look terrible or just be kind of wheeled out. And the guy looks great and was sharp as a tack. I think he's 90.
Good.
Amazing.
Good. That's good to know.
Yeah. All right.
All right.
Buddy,
I love you, buddy. Eddie Pepitone. We got to do this more often.
Yep. All right, Dave.
Give my love to Karen. Give my love to Charlotte, but not Basil.
Okay.
Bye. Bye. Time once again for Tuesdays with Corey. Professor Corey Brettschneider teaches constitutional law at Brown, and I've somehow convinced him to come on the show once a week to give me a $5 million legal education. That's how expensive a law education has gotten. It has doubled since the last time the professor has been on my show.
That's a special price for you, $5
million. My mother says I'm disrespectful to you. She listens, and she says, you need to call him Pontiff, not Corey, not Professor. She said, any man with your credentials and patience should be the Pope. Today we're going to talk about libel laws and President Trump and the Constitution. Your brief, your friend of the court brief on the travel ban, opposing it. First up, Ryan Seacrest has been named Kelly Ripa's co-host on Monday. What are your thoughts, Professor? Is this good for the Constitution of Ryan Seacrest? Is he doing too much?
I just love that you begin with the most important pressing issues of the day. And I have 3 points about this.
The First Amendment is... Is there ever an overabundance of speech with Ryan Seacrest? The guy has a radio show, TV shows, now he's going to be on Kelly. Is there any way to protect the American people from too much of one person speaking?
I don't know. I guess the thing that the First Amendment protects the most is viewpoint. And so I don't know if what he's saying is enough to qualify as a viewpoint. So that might be our first question. But I really listened to him so little. I've caught in maybe 3 seconds at the most. I could not give an informed opinion.
Hey, Ann Coulter,
I wanted to clarify something.
Yeah.
We found out that Ann Coulter's speech, she was charging $20,000 to speak at Berkeley, and it was being paid for by Young Americans for Freedom and Bridge USA, outside groups coughing up the money.
Yeah.
Is that still a First Amendment issue?
That's interesting. I mean, I think it is because it was still an invitation by, I'd have to think about it, but the fact that it was money that was being funded to a Berkeley group, I think that would be enough to say that the state is involved, that there was state action. And the retraction, I guess, to now that I think about it, of the invitation, if it came from Berkeley rather than from that group, then that's enough for the state action. I mean, the institution was involved, and I think that that makes it a First Amendment case.
I hate to give Ann Coulter more time than she deserves.
Yeah.
Here's the issue, though. Let's turn it into a hypothetical.
Sure.
You have a state university.
Right.
There is a group, let's just say Young Americans for Freedom. It's a right-wing Republican organization on campus.
Mm.
And they invite Ann Coulter, and they're paying her through outside sources.
Mm-hmm.
According to the First Amendment, it's a First Amendment issue because it's state funding suppressing speech.
Yeah, the question, I mean, Berkeley gets all sorts of money in donations from private institutions, I think. I mean, some of the money is public, and then I know they do fundraising or they have a nonprofit arm. But the question in the case would be whether or not there was a government actor involved in the decision to revoke the invitation. And I think here, regardless of where the money's coming from, the institution, Berkeley, did get involved in that question. So that likely, I mean, we'd have to see more about the details, but would be enough. And I think, too, it's important, you know, I think I explained this last time, that the worry is about suppressing private individual speech. So if there was a restriction on the ability of a student group to invite her to campus, the worry is that the government, Berkeley, is intervening in the private individuals or private groups' ability to hear somebody or to invite them. And that's where the real First Amendment worry comes. If it was a, you know, commencement, will Ann Coulter receive an award or not, or something officially conferred by Berkeley? You might be able to argue that this is Berkeley conferring an honor, or the university speaking would be a way to put it in the technical terms of the university and of the First Amendment. And when the university is speaking, or when the state is speaking, it does have the ability to pick and choose who to invite or who not to invite, because the idea is that the university or the state is trying to express its own values. But this doesn't look like that kind of case. It looks like it was a private group within Berkeley or student group, and the government does not have the ability to suppress the ideas or the invitations or the expression of private individuals, or including students.
Let me, if you don't mind,
sure.
I want to push back on this a little, because obviously without the First Amendment, I'd be nothing. Well, I am nothing, but I'd be even more of nothing.
You are something.
Thank you. College campuses. If I fire a teacher, I'm the chancellor of Berkeley. It's a state school.
Right.
And I'm also the president of Harvard, which is not a state school, but it does receive federal funding.
Mm-hmm.
Same scenario. Berkeley, Harvard. One's a state school, one's supposedly a private college. There is a professor who is teaching climate change denial.
Mm-hmm.
At Berkeley, I fire him.
Mm-hmm.
And I say, you are teaching something that's inaccurate. Can he challenge me and say I'm violating his First Amendment rights?
In the Harvard case, you mean?
Well, Berkeley. Let's
in
start.
Berkeley.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, teacher firing is a different sort of case than student or private speech, because they're an employee of the university as opposed to somebody who's just attending. But yes, there are protections certainly that are afforded university professors, and although it's a different kind of case, because Berkeley is a state institution, the First Amendment applies, and you could bring a First Amendment action. In a private university, as you said, the structure is different. Now, there are other protections for tenure. For instance, there are contractual protections that come with tenure for in other areas of law that might protect your free speech, depending on the university. The university might have promised you basically free speech rights with tenure. So, you know, free speech has a lot of different ways to defend it legally, and but in the public institution case, the Constitution applies directly, so the First Amendment might be your best option.
And so at Harvard, the same thing stands. You can fire a professor or a teacher because you believe you're free to fire somebody for teaching the wrong things.
Well, thankfully, private universities and the AAUP, the Organization of Professors, have lobbied for protections generally for professors. Part of it is that there's a norm of free expression and free inquiry that comes from the profession of being a professor. It doesn't make sense to have a university if there isn't free speech and free thought in academic inquiry. And that also, I think, includes the ability to go beyond that if you're a university professor. Now, there are different ways to get that protection legally, but one might come with the contractual obligations of the university when it comes to tenure. But we're not in the realm of the First Amendment anymore in the same way that we are in the case of a public institution. But thankfully, there are rights of professors against universities legally as well in private institutions. It's just a different area of law. And it's a good thing. I mean, you can't have a university, in my opinion, without having free thought and the ability of a professor to honestly say what their research demands they say and where their inquiry leads them.
Is a state university allowed to ban somebody from the premises? Is the chancellor allowed to say, I do not want this person on campus because they're not a student and they do not reflect the values of this university, so I am banning Ann Coulter from stepping foot inside or on the property of Berkeley?
I think they do that. I mean, if certainly like from the dorms or from the buildings or if part of the campus is private, the university, I think, has the ability to control who's there and who's not for the purposes of doing the business of the university. The worry here is that this isn't just that they were worried that she was going to rob somebody. The worry was that she was disinvited because of the content or the viewpoint of what she says. And, you know, it is complicated because they were worried about security. And so we'd have to see whether or not it was impossible to have her on campus only because of the security concern. But, what's worrying to me about the case is that if she was banned, no matter how vile her views are, I have the ability and a student has the ability to hear them. And if the government, in this case the institution of Berkeley, was preventing her from coming on campus because of her viewpoint, if that's what the inquiry revealed, then that would be a very serious violation of the First Amendment. I hate what Ann Coulter says. I hate the content of her views, and I think she's deeply wrong, but she has First Amendment rights just like everyone in this country.
She has First Amendment rights. So is it fair to say that a fraternity invited her to speak at Berkeley?
Yeah.
Is that pretty much what this group is?
I don't think so. I thought they were a private conservative group that was devoted to discussions of politics.
I'm saying the organization of students at Berkeley who invited her to speak.
Yeah.
They're, for all intents and purposes, a club on campus, right?
Exactly. Correct.
And are the clubs, do they have to, if there are official clubs at a university, do you have to apply to be officially sanctioned by the university, or can anybody set up a club?
I don't know the details of this club, but there are clubs that are often receive funds from a university, from a student group, and a lot of First Amendment cases involve issues around that. A group seeks to become an official club and is denied, or I really don't know the details of this one. But
right, I'm talking about a hypothetical
right.
case. So, if let's say the school newspaper, there's an official right. school newspaper at Berkeley,
right. mm-hmm.
they invite Ann Coulter to speak.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, that's a bad example because that opens up a whole other can of worms. But I guess the point I'm making is, or the question I'm asking is, let's say there's a rugby team.
Right.
And they invite a stripper mm-hmm. to their fraternity to strip.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm the chancellor and I say, no, you can't hire a stripper.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Is that protected by First Amendment rights? There's mm-hmm. money, you know, and they're giving right. their money. That's freedom of speech now.
There is a difference in the First Amendment between expressing a political view or an opinion, the technical term that the court uses is a viewpoint, and certain kinds of content, and restrictions on viewpoints tend to be disallowed. Restrictions on obscenity in particular, and that case seems to certainly be in the realm of obscenity, are often more tolerated. So I think you're... there might be a case for the group that wants to invite exotic dancers to campus or something, but mm-hmm. It's weaker than it is in this case. I mean, this is really about, if it turns out that the worry about Coulter was her views, that's worrying, because the whole idea of go back to the core idea of why we have this protection in the first place. It's that we want to allow for the protection of all opinions, to be able to say them, to hear them, to have the free inquiry that is necessary in a democracy. And that's why it's not just a sort of random amendment. The idea is that without being able to hear all viewpoints and argue and say what you want, including the ability to criticize the government, criticize the Constitution, on all sides, then we don't live in a democracy anymore.
Right.
So that's why the rule is so strong in protection of censorship against viewpoints.
Yeah, this isn't false humility, Professor, but mm-hmm. you know more about the Constitution than I do. I know it's hard to believe. men's rights.
And you know more about the comedy world than
no,
the radio.
I don't. Is it called mens rea? What does mens rea mean?
Mens rea is usually in the criminal context, the mental state that's involved in a crime, or it's just a term for mental state.
If we kind of know that this wasn't about Ann Coulter speaking, the same mm-hmm. way Milo Yiannopoulos, the Breitbart editor who spoke or tried to speak at Berkeley, this isn't about freedom of speech. It is about freedom of speech, but the people who hired them to go to Berkeley were screaming fire in a crowded movie theater, right?
I don't know. I there is the security concern, and certainly there was violence when around some of these incidents. But I think that we have to, the whole idea of a university is that we allow free inquiry. And if it's possible to provide security and also to have controversial speakers on campus, then Berkeley, I think, is obligated to do that. And they have a security challenge that they have to figure out. But it's not acceptable to say that we're not going to have very conservative, even fascist speakers have the right of free speech because it's too dangerous. I think that would really give up on the idea that, as I said, isn't just central to the First Amendment, but central to the idea of democracy. And even if private universities aren't bound by the First Amendment, I think the very idea of a university requires that kind of free inquiry, and that they also have to figure out how to meet those security concerns. We can't just give up on the idea that you have the right to say what you want and to hear everything, because there are challenges of security. Those are going to arise in a tumultuous time, but those are the times when it's most important that we protect all viewpoints.
Let me get back to free inquiry. It wasn't free inquiry. She was charging $20,000. And it was being paid for by outside sources who were trying to prove a point
right.
about the politically correct movement. They picked Berkeley as their beachhead.
Right.
As I remember, high school, in order to have a club, you needed a faculty advisor.
Right.
To reflect the values of the institution and justify the purpose. As I see the Ann Coulter case at Berkeley, these were just a bunch of kids without, I believe, without a professor behind them, without a Berkeley representative, just a bunch of fish out of water at Berkeley. They decide to be conservatives, and they, instead of studying, they decide to let guys like David Horowitz or Young American for Freedom pay Ann Coulter to show up on campus. It has nothing to do with free inquiry.
Mm-hmm. Well, and, if you could show that.
And it's not the university. And it's not the university. There's no professors, just a bunch of kids.
Yeah. I mean, we talked about this last time. I think part of the idea of the university is that you allow students the freedom to have access to information and to ideas. Now, Berkeley, I'm sure, like all universities, has a process of applying for speakers or applying for speaker funds or applying for permits. And if you could show in a way that had nothing to do with their opinions that they were violating those rules, that would be one thing. But I haven't heard that in this case. I think what they're worried about, and that, you know, they would have a serious claim if this is true, is that they're being limited in their ability to do what any other kid on campus could do because of the content of their views. And as I said, even though I deeply disagree with them, I think they've got a right to hear whatever they want without censorship. That doesn't mean that they can violate the rules of how you invite speakers, but what the university is restricted from doing is saying you can't have your speaker because of the viewpoint that she has or that you have. Now, again, too, I mean, I see your point. You know, I don't like what Ann Coulter says one bit. I think she's way off, not just conservative, but she says things that fundamentally disrespect the idea that we're equals under law, regardless of race. Her attacks on birthright citizenship, I think, you know, go beyond the pale of reasonable inquiry. But there are ways to express that short of saying you can't speak. I think you can bring her to campus and have the university, even if it's an official voice, have other speakers criticize, condemn her. You can have protests on campus. Mm-hmm. As I think I said last time, you know, if Ann Coulter would have come to Brown, I wouldn't impose her invite. She would have a right to speak if a student group went through the process of inviting her. But I wouldn't go in to listen to her. I would stand outside and protest. And I would hope that the university president would do the same and that we would make a statement as part of the Brown community defending her right to be there, but also to criticize her.
As a consumer, as a consumer, you send your child off to college.
Yep.
Why are the children in charge?
I mean, you know, we're not just selling some ready-made thing that you can buy and, you know, we give you a degree at the end, but we're trying to create an atmosphere on college campuses of serious thought and to teach people to think in the end, not just to tell them what to think. And if you don't give them that actual ability to make mistakes, to hear different views, then, you know, the brand is killed. What you're buying becomes...
No, I disagree.
You can watch a video.
I went to see Neil Diamond.
Yeah.
And he sings Sweet Caroline. He starts to sing Sweet Caroline. And then he points the microphone at the audience. And then we're supposed to sing Sweet Caroline. And I started screaming. Nobody could hear me. No, Neil Diamond. I paid to see you sing Sweet. Everybody be quiet. I'm not interested in hearing the audience sing Sweet Caroline. You sing it. That's why I'm here. And they escorted me out, and I screamed First Amendment rights. And it was they used the Fifth Amendment, eminent domain, to build the stadium where he was singing, but the case was thrown out of... Because I did feel it was government oppression of freedom of speech. I should be able to insist that Neil Diamond sing Sweet Caroline by himself without my having to hear Herb Glossman screaming it into my right ear. But the point I'm making is you go off to college.
Yeah.
I want to hear Neil Diamond. I don't want to hear the kids.
Yeah. I guess, you know, one response is to pull it back to what you and I are doing. We've called this, you referred to the segment at some point as Corey Teaches David. Now, there could be two ways of doing it. I could talk for an hour, not stop. You could take notes, and I could see if you understood what I said.
But isn't
end.
That better?
Or we could go back and forth, and you could say things about, you know, kids on campus, and we can do what's really more of a Socratic discussion. And, I, you know, what do you learn more from? My sense is, if I were to give you a grade, you know, you've gotten a lot out of this. You've seen the right. nuances of it. You've pushed back. You've asked great questions. You read your case last week and did that beautifully. It's the interaction that matters. Well, if you try to put that on the grand scale of the university, that's also how you learn. And, okay. you know, that's the way to do it.
So slippery slope. I hate
And this. I've never seen Neil Diamond. I don't think I would pay to do that, honestly.
He's
and
great.
Maybe that. I know.
He's
I,
great.
I may be. Okay.
Oh, no, he is. He is. Neil Diamond is great. He really is.
Now we're outside my area.
Okay. So, slippery slope. I'm getting tired of the slippery slope argument because what it yeah. implies is that as a nation, we're too stupid to understand nuance. But law, as we've just demonstrated, is all about nuance. There is nuance to the First Amendment. Right?
Correct. Yeah, I mean, there's a whole other area, too, that I was going to bring in that, you know, it's not that you were bringing up something that's irrelevant. There's a whole set of cases that are about the right of clubs to exist or not exist on campus. It's different than, I think, the Coulter inquiry, but, you know, there is a very subtle area of law. So, for instance, in California, I know a lot of your listeners, especially a radio show, are in California. There was a case involving Hastings Law School. And Hastings Law School had a club on campus, an official club called the Christian Legal Society. And the Christian Legal Society didn't allow gay students to be executive officers in the organization. They couldn't be vice president or president. And the university said that they were basically going to revoke their status as an official student group. Now, that turned out to be a very complicated case. In the end, Hastings won the case. For a variety of reasons, but I guess that to me the simplest way to put what the court should have said, at least they said something very complicated, but is that, you know, sometimes when it comes to funds and what's being supported, the university has a right to just promote its own values. Now, if Christian Legal Society had been kicked off campus or denied their free speech rights or to say what they think a good Christian lawyer is and how that relates to issues of gay rights, that would have been, I think, a blatant violation. But because the case was about official student status and about funding, I think Hastings actually did the right thing. So another way to put it is, imagine that Berkeley would say, you know what, it's one thing if you want to invite Ann Coulter to campus, but we're not going to use government funds to pay for it. I think, in my view, they would have been well within their rights to do that because they'd be saying, we don't want to fund Ann Coulter. Now, there are cases to the contrary. There's a case at the University of Virginia that seems to say the opposite, where a student group that had religious content in their publications was denied funds, and they were able to win that on First Amendment grounds. But that's really a kind of cutting-edge area of law. In this book I mentioned last time, When the State Speaks, What Should It Say?, I talk about this sort of divide between the idea that sometimes the state is acting as a speaker, as a defender of its own values, and the idea that we can have viewpoint neutrality and the protection for all viewpoints in what we say. So, you know, there is nuance, and you were capturing it by talking about the funding issues in a lot of ways.
Let's talk about Donald Trump and and libel laws.
Yeah.
Trump has a chief of staff named Rince Priebus. He is a murderer. He's killed 14 male prostitutes. He wears a Nazi outfit. He walks through the White House in full SS regalia. And he said over the weekend that his administration is looking into opening up libel laws.
Wow, I just love how you make yourself the test case. You just volunteer. I did make it clear that I'm not a member of the bar and that I'm not going to be defending you, right, in any of these cases.
Well,
I love it, but, you know, also...
Rince Priebus.
You're doing it.
Rince Priebus, who has been writing checks to the Hungarian Nazi Party for 20 years, wants to open up libel laws and make it easier to sue journalists and media personalities.
Do you want to make it clear to listeners that you're doing a subtle thing with the facts there, and that you're helping yourself to the protection of the First Amendment, or right? I mean,
what is the
that's what you're doing? You
don't know what evidence. I don't know what you're talking about.
He's
what
a bad guy, maybe, but we don't have evidence that he's.
Well, I mean, if you think calling somebody who killed 14 male prostitutes in April. And then ate them. If you think that's a bad guy, I mean, I think it's worse than bad. But if you think Rince Priebus, a notorious.
We are on the cutting edge of the First Amendment right here. Thank God for the case I'm going to tell you about, because that's your best chance at a defense against the libel lawsuit that he's going to bring.
What is the difference?
And the fact that it's clearly satire, and I'll add that disclaimer.
What is the difference between
David Feldman, a comedy satire show, not a factual news inquiry?
Thank you, Hustler Magazine, I believe,
that's right?
Hustler, I think Hustler Magazine defended my right to say that. What is the difference between slander and libel?
Libel, I think, is boy, now I'm going to have to look this up. Maybe we can cut it if I'm wrong. But libel is a written false statement, a published false statement.
And libel is saying a false statement with the intent to hurt somebody, to damage the reputation, right?
Well, that's the issue. So, you know, you just now likely committed, well, I guess you didn't publish it in print, but slander, that you made a falsehood about Priebus, satire, of course. But the question that Trump and his brought up over the summer, and now his staff is actively pursuing, it's a frightening thing, is the question of whether or not, if we go back to a case called New York Times versus Sullivan, whether or not the Supreme Court was correct to say that when it comes to public figures and issues of public concern, that we weren't going to allow libel lawsuits to just go through if there was a little bit of falsehood or a small mistake in there. So in particular, during the civil rights movement, there was a strategy to try to bankrupt civil rights organizations on the grounds that they were occasionally taking out ads that had falsehoods in them.
Right.
So in particular, I think in New York Times versus Sullivan, there was an issue about a publication of one of these ads that talked about how many times Martin Luther King had been arrested. And the claim in the libel suit that was brought against the civil rights organization was that they got the number wrong. Now, technically, you know, if you get the number wrong about the number of times that King was arrested, that's a falsehood. That's not true. And in a very strict libel regime where any libel was subject to suit, you could be sued for libel. Now, the thought of the court, and this was, I think, an important thought, was you don't want to allow that. You want to protect small mistakes, because if anybody can be sued if they say just a small thing wrong, they're going to be afraid to speak out again in public matters against public officials. And the whole idea of the First Amendment is we want more rather than less speech. So it's not that they abolished the rule of libel when it comes to public officials, but they required actual malice, that you really try to hurt somebody in your falsehood. In finding for the civil rights organization, they protected, used the First Amendment to protect a wider amount of speech. Does that make sense?
I want to, this is important to me. The case is, what is it, Sullivan?
New York Times versus Sullivan.
New York Times versus Sullivan. As I remember, as you just said, there was a civil rights organization that published a full page ad in the New York Times accusing a sheriff in the South of targeting Martin Luther King, and they got the number wrong. But it wasn't the New York Times.
Number of arrests.
The number of arrests.
Right.
The myth about Sullivan versus the New York Times is that they were suing the New York Times for its reportage, but that's reporting. professor, reporter.
Thank you. Thank you.
I just, you know.
Good word.
Thank you. So they were defending the full page ad that the New York Times printed.
Right.
And correct. It gave the ruling from, I believe, the Warren Court gave the New York Times and all journalists after that the right to be factually incorrect as long as it wasn't malicious.
Right. Exactly. Yes.
So
and the idea is that, it might be a different case if I wrote something about, a coworker or somebody that had no public presence and published it online and said something just false about them. They could probably sue me on grounds that, I was negligent, should have known that I was writing something that was wrong or that I was, in fact, wrong. But in this case, the reason why it's a First Amendment case is that there's an interest in allowing for even false speech, if it's not intentional, we're not trying to hurt somebody, in order to to make it comfortable, incentivize speaking out about mm-hmm. public officials.
How much of Sullivan versus the New York Times is the one of the backbones to Citizens United, that decision? Was that cited? I would assume it would be because Citizens United, and I guess it was 2010, the Roberts Court said that money is speech because you need money to buy a full page ad in the New York Times.
I see. I think it's just a different area of law.
Okay. All right.
That's really an issue about whether or not private corporations can spend money from their own treasury on campaign statements. This is a separate issue that's about whether or not you're going to be subject to laws, private laws, in which one person can sue another for saying a falsehood. And I don't think one necessarily.
Okay, then looking at an organization like Breitbart News,
right,
which can be malicious, or the National Enquirer, although I think a lot of their stuff is accurate, can you sue? Well, you can sue the National Enquirer and win.
Yeah, if you could show. I mean, there are really two. What you were doing was satire, but if I say that a public official is having an affair in order to try to hurt them when I know it's not true and I'm only doing it to try to hurt them, they probably can, and I do this in print, they could probably bring a libel lawsuit against me. But what this protects are these sort of more small mistakes. So think about every time somebody writes something about Trump, if he could find something about the number of hotels that he owns or the amount of money he made on a deal, and it was reported in a way that wasn't exactly 100% accurate, and he could sue, that would scare people. News organizations would be really reluctant to report on his finances or try to, give answers about basic things to do with his presidency or his background, because they'd fear being sued by him. But what New York Times versus Sullivan does is it says, you know what, if you make a small mistake and you weren't intentionally trying to hurt Trump, but you were being honest in your reporting, or even if you were, negligent, but you weren't trying to hurt him, we're going to protect you. And the idea is what we really care about is getting the information out there so that citizens can make decisions for themselves in the democratic process.
How calculated is Rush Limbaugh? How calculated is Ann Coulter? Because here's what they do. They play fast and loose with the truth, and they make wild accusations. And then mm-hmm. they hide behind the cloak of satire. Talk to mm-hmm. me for a second about Jerry Falwell versus Larry Flint. And is Rush Limbaugh, I know you can't go in their head, but are they, because they always fall back on, I was joking. I was, mm-hmm. that was a joke. When they get cornered, they claim to be comedians. Talk to me about Jerry Falwell versus Larry Flint and mm-hmm. my right to make jokes about Rhys Priebus, even though I'm malicious. I do. I want people to believe that he's this way. I hate Donald Trump. Let me rephrase the question. What is malicious intent? I would like people to despise Rince Priebus. I think nobody should ever hire him again.
Right.
I think he's a disgrace. My jokes do come from malice.
Right, but you're not trying to spread the lie of, you know, whatever the nonsense that you said was in an effort to get people to really believe it. You were engaging in, and I hope you agree with me.
Well, no.
I really don't want to see this guy come after you. You were engaging in a satire.
Am I?
Yes, you don't have any evidence, and you know that you don't have any evidence of him walking around in a Nazi uniform. You imagine that, and it's funny. But it's, you know, the radio equivalent of what Larry Flint would do when he depicted in Hustler magazine in a parody the Jerry Falwell as being drunk. It's not that, you know, he was trying to say this guy's really a drunk. He was making fun of him. And what the court said in a very sensible decision, I believe it was unanimous in Hustler magazine versus Falwell, is just following up on that idea that we were talking about with New York Times versus Sullivan, that if you're engaging in a parody of public figures, then you're protected from private lawsuits like a tort claim that says you were trying to inflict emotional distress.
I'm serious. Listen, I wrote on the Ann Coulter roast.
Yeah. You're engaging in satire. You're doing what Falwell did. You're making fun of the person, you're exaggerating facts in order to use humor. But that's very different than going out and saying to somebody, hey, you know what? Jerry Falwell is really a drunk, you know, with no humor involved. It's the humor in a way that protects you.
But Your Honor, I'm confessing to you.
Yeah, you're trying to, but thankfully I'm not going to allow it.
I have malice. I'm being serious. I wrote on the Rob Lowe roast.
Yeah.
Ann Coulter was on that roast.
Yeah, I watched it. It was unbelievable.
It was pure malice.
Every joke came
from hatred.
Hatred. I could tell. That's why it's so enjoyable to watch.
but doesn't that run counter? Isn't that flying in the face of the Jerry Falwell case?
I could see how they would Falwell might make that kind of argument, but I think what the court's saying, which is sensible, is that there's a difference between truly trying to get people to believe a lie and using humor because you don't like them, something like that, or you want people to dislike them. The latter is okay. If I'm using these sort of cartoonish facts to mock somebody, and you know, I don't want them to be reelected, for instance, in the sort of court case of Trump, then that's fine. Or I don't want them to read Ann Coulter anymore, or to pay her, or to believe in give Jerry Falwell money. I want to expose them as a fraud or somebody that's not worthy of respect. And I use comedy or satire to do that, or parody. Then the court's saying that's fine. That's protected.
As long as she's trying to get somebody
to believe something fake about them.
As long as she's
in fact, you're trying to get them to believe something real, right? Isn't that the idea, that she really is bad, or that that Trump really is a fraud? I think that's the idea.
And she has to be a public figure.
Yes, that's central. I mean, don't do this, you know, with your coworker. It's a completely different case.
And how do you measure a public figure?
I think there's no, you know, empirical test, but in the case of Donald Trump, I think those in the White House or in the news all the time, they're sort of the paradigmatic example of public figures, politicians, people who we're talking about. And Falwell is famous enough that the court said there that he also, even though he wasn't a politician, that he qualified as a public figure. But, you know, somebody who's never been written about in a newspaper or has lived a completely private life, that's an easy case on the other side. Looks like they're not. That's why I keep saying don't try this with your co-workers. Don't do it anyway, because it might not be nice, but you're not going to get the First Amendment protection.
So Donald Trump gave an interview recently where he said that the Constitution is archaic. This is a man who believes in appointing originalists to the Supreme Court, but he himself believes that the Supreme Court is archaic.
Right. The whole Constitution, I think he was talking about. Checks and balances.
Yeah. Although I before the show started, I kind of listened to him, and it's taken out of context. He's blaming Senate rules. I know when Obama was president, we were complaining about Senate rules, which you've pointed out are not the Constitution. There are some parts of the Constitution that are archaic. You teach constitutional law.
Mm-hmm.
What if President Obama or Hillary Clinton said the Constitution is archaic? It was written more than 200 years ago. Mm-hmm. It's slowing progress down. Mm-hmm. We need a constitutional convention. We have to rewrite the Constitution. Would you support that?
Well, a lot of people are saying that, and we're saying it before Trump was elected. I guess my view is that I have never had more faith in the Constitution than I have in the last, certainly 100 days, but really since Trump began to run. There's a classic defense of checks and balances and strong role of judicial review in the Supreme Court, that it's a defense and a bulwark against tyranny. Now, a lot of people, I think, before Trump was elected said, you know what? That's really a silly argument. We have a good constitutional culture in the polity. We're not going to elect a demagogue to the highest office in the land. And the idea that we need this degree of protection is a mistake. And this is getting in the way, as you said, of progress. And I just don't believe that anymore. Factually, it's not true. We elected a demagogue who is completely opposed not just to small instances of checks and balances or Senate rules, and I interpret what he was saying in that quote in a different way. I think he really doesn't like the fact that the courts struck down his travel ban based on animus, that they are stopping him from deporting massive numbers of people by going after sanctuary cities, and that he doesn't like the fact that he has to deal with Congress and passing legislation. He doesn't like the system. Because it stopped him from just implementing his really bizarre and pernicious agenda. So, you know, I am a complete believer in the Constitution now, in checks and balances. I think, frankly, it's the one thing that saved us over the last 100 days. It's what's thrown him off kilter and prevented an even more radical, not just right wing, but I'll say it, I believe it, authoritarian, autocratic agenda from taking place. We stopped him because of the Constitution. So I'm not surprised he doesn't like it.
Yeah. I do you have Trump fatigue?
No. I'm getting more energy every day watching him lose. I love it.
Help me, because listeners to this show know that I have Trump fatigue. That I've been inviting a lot of comedians on the show, and it's your eyes don't glaze over. Don't you get tired of being lied to and addressing stupidity?
I think we're being tested on a daily basis, and that all the stuff that I was just talking about, which used to be like weird, you know, you learn it in politics 101 or in con law, and then people's eyes glaze over because who cares? That every day that he lies, that he tries to, you know, deport people or to attack the, as he puts it, the open up the libel laws, that these are it's a test for the Constitution and for people around the country to stand up to a potential tyrant. Now, you know, a lot of people think, oh, we were overreacting. What's the big deal? The system's working. But it's working because people are standing up to him. So I feel invigorated. And I think it's, you know, people will look back on this and he's not going to win. His agenda won't be implemented, but it's because we're not going to get tired and we're going to keep challenging him.
All right, help me out here, Professor. I'm being serious. I'm being really serious about this.
Me too.
My question is, where's my juice? Where's the problem that I've had since Trump got elected is I cling to the New York Times, to the Washington Post, and they're fighting the big fight. They're fighting the rational they're being rational, and they're waiting. They're holding their fire till they gather up all the ammo, and then boom, Bill O'Reilly's gone. I mean, it was masterful what they did.
Right.
A month ago, they wrote this article, and next thing you know, Bill O'Reilly's gone. So they're very circumspect because they're in the crosshairs. Where's the juice? Where's the thing that gets your heart beating every morning? I just looked at the Palmer Report, which is covering Russia. And kind of like a Walter Winchell type of left-wing view of the Trump administration. Where do you go for your juice? Not your rational discourse, just the juice.
I mean, I'd say that just reading everyday news reports of what he's doing, it doesn't come from a particular publication. It comes from seeing people fight back. So take this way of defeating his executive order about sanctuary cities. I mean, these were local officials that stood up to him and used actually conservative Federalist Society precedents. When I say Federalist Society, I mean a lot of the members of the conservative bar argued for states' rights and for limits when it came to the spending clause. And now that series of precedents is being used by local officials to stand up to Donald Trump. That just reading that news story in any one source is evidence that the Constitution is working, that there are judges implementing it. Same with the travel ban, same with Congress, at least members of Congress torpedoing his attempt to disable Obamacare. So, I mean, I'm just every day, any news story that's about him losing gives me energy.
Okay. Before you go, I want to talk to you about your friend of the court brief on the travel ban, which I didn't read. I didn't do my assignment. I want to ask you for an assignment.
Okay.
But before I ask you for an assignment and we talk about the assignment I didn't complete, I want to talk to you about the process of completing assignments. There's this this is a very important to me. There was this great piece in the New York Times about 6 months ago that mythologized the Obama Camelot. I have a feeling Michelle Obama was behind this piece in the New York Times, much the same way that Jackie Kennedy was behind the notion of Camelot after Jack died. It's the seven almonds. It's President Obama sitting in the treaty room of the White House. He puts the kids to bed. He's a constitutional law professor. And from 8 till 2 in the morning, every day, every night, he would sit and read with ESPN going in the background. Mm. But he would spend about 6 hours a day in the treaty room of the White House with a yellow legal canary reading, and they would bring him 8 almonds. And friends of mine, we called it the 8 almonds story. Mm. What is your regimen for reading? Do you view reading as an indulgence or a necessity? And how can my listeners, or the hell with my listeners, how can I say to myself each day, reading is a necessity, I have to carve this time out?
Mm-hmm. I don't know that I have a special technique. I mean, I'm trying to write a lot these days, so I'm kind of religious about usually when I'm not talking to you in the morning, writing in the morning. And I think when I've got things that I'm writing that I absolutely need to get more information about, I'll use that time too to sometimes I'll just replace it with reading for 2 or 3 hours. But yeah, I think clear blocks of time and making it a priority if it's something that you really want to know about. You know, I don't think just reading around always is the most focused thing, but I think having a question that you want answered and then reading around that question can sometimes be the way to do it.
This is very important to me.
Yeah.
For my new listeners, because we're always gathering up new listeners, we had Mr. Methane on the show last week. He's a flatulent artist out of Great Britain. And in the tradition of Lepetamane. And so we have a lot of his fans now listening to the show. So they may not know that you have a master's in philosophy from Cambridge, where I think Mr. Methane might have walked by Cambridge because he's from Great Britain. Is it Cambridge where you got your master's in philosophy?
Yeah.
Yes, and you have a PhD in political science from Princeton. I think Mr. Methane has heard of Princeton. And then you have a law degree from Stanford. And Mr. Methane has never been to California. But so I forgot the question. No. So you're
just were enjoying that contrast.
By the way, Mr. I never, if you heard the interview, and I suggest you, I never allowed him to perform. I interviewed him for about 40 minutes, and we just talked about the craft and his instrument and how he did. And do you know that I have a lawsuit? It's not methane, by the way, but that's not none of your business. That's not fair to you. But the point I'm making is you are very well educated. Do you view reading as your job? Do you say, this is my job? My job is to read, and if somebody distracts me, you're making it impossible for me to do what I'm supposed to be doing.
Yeah, I mean, to the extent that I need it for issues, especially that I'm working on, I try to read a lot about things I'm writing about, and you know that requires a lot of research, and I like to go deep into the facts, and to, if it's a legal issue, to really know not just the specific on point case law, but things that are related to it and scholarship. So yeah, it's a, you know, it's a big part of what I'm doing. Is
when you were learn. I don't know, was there an internet when you started law school?
It had early internet, but yeah, there was an internet. It was not as developed as it is now, certainly. But
are you reading case law? Are you reading on the internet, or are you reading actual books?
No, I'm reading on the internet. I mean, I was right at the edge of when you would kind of go into the library, and I still remember actually our first year we did learn about that system.
Well, they had LexisNexis.
Yeah, but they already had LexisNexis. And
are you distracted? Are you able to immerse yourself when you're reading on a tablet? Are you distracted and looking up other things and hitting hyperlinks, or can you stay focused, or do you go down rabbit holes?
Yeah, I mean, it depends. If I'm working, I try to, I think I am pretty focused, and because I'm trying to get some information, and so I'm able to read in a different way. But if it's the afternoon and I'm just reading a newspaper or looking at something online, I'd find it distracting. But, you know, I still get the paper, the hard copy of the paper. So that's one way to focus, is there are no hyperlinks.
Right, right.
And, you know, I think that's a good thing. I'm all for the existence of hard copies of the newspaper, that you could sit with your coffee and go and sit outside and really just read it thoroughly.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for your time. Before you go, I want to ask about the amicus.
Yeah, sure.
Is it amicus curiae?
Yeah.
That means friend
of the court. Yep.
You wrote one on the travel ban. Where are we on this?
I did it with a lawyer, Joshua Matz, and two friends and colleagues, Nelson Tebbe from Brooklyn Law School and Micah Schwartzman from the University of Virginia. And the four of us together wrote a brief that the court will hopefully the courts will hopefully read in the Ninth Circuit and Fourth Circuits about why it is that Trump's own statements about the travel ban and his own claims during the campaign and since that this is about a shutdown of Muslim immigration, as well as statements by people like Rudy Giuliani saying that Trump had this Muslim ban and he asked him to make it legal, that those all go to what we think is the central issue in the case, and that's that the issue in Lukumi, that you can't have law that's based on animus, that you can't try to discriminate against people based on their religion. And if that's your motivation for a law, even if there were other ways perhaps to craft it that would make it legal, that that makes it unconstitutional. So we're really pulling out. That's why we spent so much time last week, and you were, did it in such depth and with such grace, looking at that case about animus, because we think it's the same issue in this one as well. So
right.
We have more than 45 law professors from around the country who have signed on to it from different walks of life, including real superstars of constitutional law like Lawrence Tribe and Jeffrey Stone. And they're all agreeing with us that this is really the basis of why the travel ban is unconstitutional, that it's based in unconstitutional motivation of animus.
Great. Give us an assignment.
You know, I thought, especially given our discussion today, maybe we could read this very complicated but interesting case called the you seem to like it the more difficult it is and the more you could get into it. And I think talking about the nuance of the First Amendment and free speech, this Christian Legal Society case might be great for listeners. So let's make the assignment Christian Legal Society versus Martinez. A case about the official student status of the student group at Hastings Law School.
Great. Martinez, and how do we find that case?
The last time I told people that they could just Google the name of the case, Christian Legal Society versus Martinez and Cornell, and it'll come up on that public site. You could also use a public site called OYEZ, O-Y-E-Z, where you can actually listen to the oral arguments if you really want extra credit.
Wow.
And I'd say one of those two sites.
Okay. Great. And I apologize to my listeners because I said if you contact me, if you read Lukume, I will send you a gift. And I have been behind on the emails, and I want to apologize to my listeners because I got several emails.
People who read it? Great.
Yeah. You know what? I wasn't surprised.
Yeah.
There's a nice flow to this show, and we have our vegetables at the end. I'm very satisfied with my listeners, especially to the ones who are listening right now. Professor Corey Brettschneider teaches constitutional law at Brown. Thank you, Pontiff. Did you learn anything from me? Reportage. Always. Let's just make sure reportage means.
Is that reporting?
Yes, very good. Very good.
Yeah, thank your mother, too. I'm a huge fan of hers.
Thank you, Pontiff.
Love that she's talking me up.
Thank you, Pope Corey Brettschneider. Well, let's do next Tuesday.
Yeah. How'd your show go, by the way, your live show?
People came out.
Great.
We did it at QED.
Yeah.
And we didn't sell it out. It was 7:30 on a Saturday night. And we only really plugged it through Facebook and this show. And we have listeners all over the world. I was surprised by the number of people who showed up. I have to say that it is the greatest feeling in the world to meet the listeners.
Right.
And it's bizarre. It's not like stand-up. These are people who devote a huge chunk of their time listening to this. And I thank them for that. And I won't waste their time. I we just did an hour, and I wanted it to be a half hour because I don't want to waste your time. And my mother says, don't waste the Pope's time. I can't waste people's time. And I definitely got a sense that people who came to the show were grateful that I don't waste their time. So
terrific.
But now I'm wasting their time thanking them for appreciating.
Well, I'm from Queens, and I love the idea that you're out in my home.
Are you from Queens?
Yeah, absolutely.
Antonin Scalia country.
Is that where he's from too?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Oh, I love it. Yeah, good place. And different folks come from there, I guess. But it sounded great. I saw a few of your mentions and a few of the comics who were there, and looked like a terrific show.
Well, we want to do more live shows. I want to do a live show once a week, and I'd like to put you together with
I'd be on a panel together in
with Mrs. Methane.
Yeah. I do remember, just for the record, that there was flatulence at Cambridge University, Princeton University, and Stanford Law School. All people in all three locations had flatulence. So.
Yeah, the blowhards.
Not unheard of.
The teaching. That's... Well, great. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you.
On the line. Always. We're going to stop. Just please stay on the line for 1 second.
Okay.
Today's show is brought to you by Medicare for All. Ask your doctor if Medicare for All is right for you. Special thanks to Professor Corey Brettschneider, Eddie Pepitone, Colleen Werthmann, and Liam McEneaney. Please friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Please go to the David Feldman Show website. We have new premium content up there for $5 a month. You can gain access to all our premium content. We accept all major credit cards. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Hit the Go Premium banner, and we take all major credit cards for as little as $5 a month. You can support this important show, which keeps getting more and more important. From the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.
Yes! Howdy, partner.
What's up, Basement Masturbators? I'm Colleen Werthmann. You're listening to The David Feldman Show.
Yo, yo, yo. You listen to the hottest show on podcast. I'm Liam McEneaney. It's David Feldman Show right now.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.